Hey, what's up, everybody? This is Dante Fortson here. I got an awesome study for you guys tonight. We're going to be talking about Nebuchadnezzar and the Black Hebrew Israelites. And for those that don't know, we do not call ourselves Black Hebrew Israelites. However, the YouTube algorithm is on fire with that search term. So that term is going in the title so that people will actually watch the video when they run across it. So a lot has been said about us using the Bible to confirm our identity. And so then some of us began using DNA. Some of us began using history. I've even broken it down with the mathematics. The fact is, it's undeniable that many of us, I'm not going to say all, but many of us are descendants of the biblical Israelites. I've seen some of these Christian apologists, most recently, Dr. Michael Brown. I don't know if he considers himself a Christian apologist. He tries to make the claim, and it seemed like he was trying to lump everybody in together because he mentioned my name, my book, and then he started talking about radical Hebrew Israelites. And it seems like he's trying to lump everybody together under one belief, which is deception. And I'm just going to call it what it is. Y'all can forward him this part, tell him whatever you want to. I'm going to be 100% clear. If you are not being 100% truthful about an entire group of people, you are a deceiver. You are a liar and you're a deceiver. As simple as that. If you're trying to lump everybody together under the same belief, you are a deceiver. And many of the Christian apologists are deceivers. And I'm going to show you some of that today. And some of the biggest problems we face are people who are historically ignorant and illiterate. They haven't done much research. I have been researching this specific topic since 2015. History in general has been a interest of mine since probably middle school. And so I have read a lot of history. I have read a lot of mythology. You can ask anybody who is really set and talk with me in a real conversation off the, just off the top of the head. We can discuss history, and a lot of people don't know as much about history as they think they know. So before we get into the lesson today, check out Undeniable, Full Color Evidence of Black Israelites in the Bible. If you're tired of arguing with people about the evidence, show them the images. And if they don't like the images, grab Undeniable 2, Historical Evidence of Black Israelites in the Bible. That goes through some of the best sources, not all the sources, but the best sources. And you can get both of these books on Amazon.com and BarnesandNoble.com. And if you guys are unaware of the stuff that I've published, you can go on Amazon.com and type in my name, Dante Fortson. It is spelled D-A-N-T-E. I'll say it again, D-A-N-T-E. Not none of these other weird names or spellings that people do. D-A-N-T-E. That's how you spell the name. And you can look me up on Amazon and you can see all the work there. So check that out if you haven't done so already. If you want to support the channel, you can do so in the super chat while we are live. After the show, you can hit the super thanks right below the video. Make sure you check out the merch shop. If you want to support on an ongoing basis, you can go to patreon.com/Dante Fortson. And of course, anytime with Cash App at #BHITB. All right. So now I want to show you guys how the Census Bureau defines race in America. And we're going to start there. And from there, we are going to get into some interesting stuff. And Cambridge University is going to come up again. I find it interesting that people like to try to attack the Cambridge source that I use as if it's the only Cambridge source. People act like I only have a couple of sources. And so they will attack a couple of sources and claim they debunked it. Now, again, this is part of the deception. When you hear people saying they've debunked stuff, if they have not, if they claim to have debunked a university document, that's not how academia works. You don't just come out and say, oh, I debunked it. No, you have to get peer review. You have to get a retraction printed from that university because their reputation is on the line. And if you're going around claiming you debunked a university and you actually did not, you are a deceiver. If you didn't go the proper channels and the proper route to debunk a university, you're just out here talking. If you're not giving your sources, if you're leaving out information such as Kovy the Clown did. You got some of you guys know who Kovy the Clown is. If you don't know who Kovy the Clown is, don't worry about it. You guys are going to see some stuff tonight. I'm not going to particularly talk about him, but I'm going to show you how these deceivers operate with history. They don't like to corroborate. They'll take one source and say, okay, well, I debunked this source. And then they'll take another source and say, I debunked this source, but they don't want to show you where there is corroboration across multiple sources from multiple dates. Or if they know, they will leave it out. So let's start here with the Census Bureau. United States Census Bureau, about the topic of race. Now, I just want you guys to see something. And this is going to explain a lot when it comes to race, how race is defined, and why people are deceived into believing that there's such a thing as a Middle Eastern skin color. Or they'll say that Jesus wasn't black or white. He was brown. They want to put him in the middle because they can't accept that God is hot or cold. He's either going to go one way or the other. They want the lukewarm ethnicity. They want brown, right? Directly in the middle. It's safe. If he's black, they don't want the black Messiah. A lot of them will say they don't care. And then they will argue against him being black and tell you, well, he was brown because he was born in the Middle East. This right here, as soon as somebody tells you that Jesus was olive, brown, or Middle Eastern, understand they are historically ignorant and historically illiterate. There is no Middle Eastern color, because if you understand history, you understand that there were African black people or black. Let's back up. Let's not use the word African outside of the continent, because there were multiple people on the continent of multiple races. There were black Hamites that were in the area. There were white Europeans that were invading the area. And later on, we're going to see the Arab invasions. People are completely historically ignorant. So I think it was about 300 BC or so when the invasions started. Roughly 300 BC when the invasions started into what we call the Middle East and Northern Africa. And so over time, the people began to mix and become lighter. It did not always look like that. People claim that this place always looked like that. And I'm going to show you today that it did not. So let's read this Census Bureau. And then we're going to look at the Bible and see what the Bible has to say about that area. The U.S. Census Bureau must adhere to the 1997 Office of Management and Budget, OMB, standards on race and ethnicity, which guide the Census Bureau in classifying written responses to the race question. Now, remember, since 300 BC, roughly, there have been multiple invasions by Europeans and Arabs into the what we call the Middle East and Northern Africa. Now, I'm only using the term Northern Africa to differentiate at the moment. I'm going to show you guys some videos that talk about the deception of Northern Africa versus Sub-Saharan Africa. When people use those terms and they don't tell you that those terms are very deceptive, it's because they are trying to deceive you. There's no magical, mythical boundary line that keeps people from going from Sub-Saharan Africa to Northern Africa and Northern Africa to Sub-Saharan Africa and into South Africa. There's no mystical, magical boundary lines that do this. People migrated from one place to the other. If you don't believe it, go watch my DNA journey videos. My DNA says that there is a high likelihood that my DNA traces back to the Levant, which is considered Northern Africa / Middle Eastern area. So if I was Sub-Saharan Africa, African, because I'm 48% Nigerian, go back and watch my DNA journey videos, 48% Nigerian. And yet it says that my paternal ancestor originated or may have originated in the Levant area, which is not part of Sub-Saharan Africa. And a lot of people are seeing these things in their DNA. And so they've claimed that we read the DNA wrong, and we know that's not true. So let's look at how they classify race. White, a person having origins in any of the original peoples of Europe, the Middle East, and North Africa. Let's stop right there. So if you're white, you are a person having origins in any of the original peoples. Now, notice how they say that. The original peoples of Europe, the Middle East, and North Africa. They are saying that the original people of Europe, the Middle East, and North Africa were white. I want you to let that sink in. They say the original Middle Easterns and North Africans were white. So wait, when people say that Christ looked Middle Eastern, they assume that they're saying that he looks brown or olive or any of these other skin tones they come up with Middle East. And yet when you go to the official classifications from the Census Bureau, who must adhere to the 1997 Office of Management and Budget, it says that to be Middle Eastern is to be white. But I'm going to keep reading, and just real quick, you'll notice that black or African American is here, American Indian or Alaskan Native is here, Asian is here, Native Hawaiian or other Pacific Islander is here, but you do not see a group listed as Arab or Middle Eastern, because Middle Easterners are considered white. North Africans are considered white by the Census Bureau. Now, before we can, well, actually, you know what? I'll show that in a second. Let me read through these and I'll go back to that because I don't want to get sidetracked. A black or African American, a person having origins in any of the black racial groups of Africa. So anywhere on the continent, you're considered black or African American. But it's, if you're specifically from North Africa, the Middle East, or Europe, you're considered white. American Indian or Alaskan Native, a person having origins in any of the original peoples of North and South America, including Central America, and who maintains tribal affiliation or community attachment. One more time, a person having origins in any of the original peoples of North and South America, including Central America, and who maintains tribal affiliation or community attachment. So you're only considered an American Indian or an Alaska Native if you're part of the original peoples of North and South America. Where's Mexican? They are classified as American Indians. I'm just pointing out what it says here. Mexicans, Colombians, Brazilians, all those people are classified as American Indian or Alaska Native, but only, right here, you have to maintain your tribal affiliation or community attachment. If you do not, you are not considered that. You fall somewhere else. Let's keep going. I'm just reading what's written here. A person, Asian, a person having origins in any of the original peoples of the Far East, Southeast Asia, or the Indian subcontinent, including, for example, Cambodia, China, India, Japan, Korea, Malaysia, Pakistan, the Philippine Islands, Thailand, and Vietnam. So all those people are considered Asian. Most of us agree on what is considered Asian. We look at people and say, hey, that person's Asian. Now let's keep going. It says Native Hawaiian or other Pacific Islander, a person having origins in any of the original peoples of Hawaii, Guam, Samoa, or other Pacific Islands. Seems pretty much self-explanatory. If you're a native of Hawaii or the Pacific Islands, you're considered Native Hawaiian or other Pacific Islander. So now, I'll close this out and I'll ask a few questions. The 1997 OBM standards permit the reporting of more than one race. An individual's response to the race question is based upon self-identification. But notice there's nowhere that I see right here that you can identify as Spanish or any of the other Spanish classifications, Middle Eastern or Arab. If you're from the Middle East, you are considered white. If you are a native of North or South America, you're considered American Indian or Alaska Native. Now, An individual's response to the race question is based upon self-identification. The Census Bureau does not tell individuals which boxes to mark or what heritage to write in. For the first time in Census 2000, individuals were presented with the option to self-identify with more than one race, and this continued with the 2010 Census. People who identify with more than one race may choose to provide multiple races in response to the race question. For example, if a respondent identifies as Asian and white, they may respond to the question on race by checking the appropriate boxes that describe their racial identities and or writing in these identities on the spaces provided. All right, so if they don't mention your race, you can write it in. But their official classifications are white, black, American Indian, Asian, and Native Hawaiian or other Pacific Islander. So now, to prove to you that it does not matter what your skin color is when it comes to race, it only matters what your place of origin is when it comes to race in America, they will force black people to classify as white if a black person identifies as one of the original people of North Africa or Egypt. I'll say that again. If you are black and you identify as one of the original people of North Africa, Egypt area, Middle East, they will force you to classify yourself as white. I just read it right here. White, a person having origins in any of the original peoples of Europe, the Middle East, or North Africa. So now, I'm going to let you see a video driving home my point about forcing black people to identify as white if they originate in North Africa or Egypt.
I am a black Egyptian. My father is much darker than I am. My mother is lighter than I am. In Egypt, people are identified by the religion first, not the race. So in Egypt, if you are Christian, you are a minority person. But if you're black, you're not a minority person. You are a part of the mainstream society. And I came from this background. And in Egypt, you identify as Arab and as Muslim. And in this country, when I first came, I identified myself as Arab American and Muslim first. And gradually, I became to identify myself as black. I came to the US in 1978. And I became U.S. citizen in 1985. When I became a U.S. resident, I was told by the Immigration and Naturalization that I am white. And I told them that I am black, and they said, no, in this country, you are white. All Arabs in this country, all Arab immigrants are white. I didn't pay much attention in the beginning to this, because in the Arab world, we identify with our ethnicity first as Arabs, and then with the race second as black or white or whatever. But in this country, you identify with your racial group first and then with your ethnicity second. Gradually, I became black first and Arab second. And I rejected my white classification publicly for the first time in 1987, in February, as a panelist in a function sponsored by the Association of the Study of Black Life and History in Detroit. I said that I belong to two minority groups. I am Arab American and Black American. And I'm racially black and ethnically Egyptian. I was harassed by my employer right after that. I work for a white school district. The superintendent is white. All the associate superintendents are white, even though that we provide services to 30% black population. But the organization is white and the approach is very white. The attitude towards me changed completely after I went out publicly and rejected my white classification. One coworker came to me and told me right after the function that he met with the superintendent, and if I don't keep my mouth shut, my educational career is over. He said, you have nothing to do with these people. You have a history and a culture. These people came from the jungle. You have nothing to do with them. These people lie and steal. When I see one of them in my neighborhood, I call the police. And I was told by the director of general education, who is retired now, in 88, I was told by him that I get people angry when I say that I'm black Egyptian. If I just say that I'm Egyptian, I would get along. I have to add that I was denied promotion twice because I chose black classification. This is part of my two lawsuits against my employer, which are currently pending. Two lawsuits.
Now, just for the education of our viewership, why don't you share with us a breakdown of Egypt as it is today, insofar as blacks or combinations thereof of European descent and what have you?
We don't have Egyptians of European descent in Egypt. We have a population which is basically the inter, which is basically a mixture of ancient Egyptian blacks who intermarried with Arabs right after the Arab conquest. The ancient Egyptian population was brown and black before the Arab conquest. But before the Arab conquest came the Greeks. It was ancient, the ancient Egyptian population was in Egypt for thousands of years. The ancient Egyptian population was brown and black. And the Greeks came in 300 BC and they started to intermarry with the local population. And then the Romans came and ruled from 70 BC until they were conquered by the Arabs and kicked out by the Arabs in the 7th century. And these people intermarried with the Egyptian Copts, and they made the they made the pigmentation of the Egyptians, the Copts, much lighter because of this intermarriage with Europeans.
Now you're an educator, okay? Now how do you deal with situations when you practice your profession, insofar as dealing with the mythology or the misconceptions about Egypt being a white civilization? How do you deal with that?
This is a big problem because Egypt, the ancient Egyptian civilization was a black civilization, and ancient Egyptians were black according to the Greek scholars and the Roman scholars. Ancient Egypt became white only in the 19th century and in the 20th century. And the scholar who is responsible for this is Seligman, the noted anthropologist from England, Seligman. White supremacy argues that blacks are inferior than white intellectually. They are subhuman and they are incapable of building a civilization. White supremacy had one dilemma until Seligman came. The dilemma was ancient Egypt was black according to the Greek and the Roman scholars. 10 of them said that, including Aristotle and Plato. 10 of them said that in writing. They had this dilemma, ancient Egyptian was black. So if blacks are inferior intellectually and are incapable of building a civilization, how come the ancient Egyptians built a civilization? Seligman found the solution for this dilemma. He came up with a theory called the Hamite theory. He separated the blacks who built a civilization in Egypt and Ethiopia from the rest of the black race, and he called them brown-skinned whites, or the Hamites. So Seligman saved white supremacy from this dilemma, and all the white scholars followed him from that time on. This was at the end of the 19th century. And since that time, white scholarship says that ancient Egypt is white.
Mustafa Hefni is currently working on his doctorate degree at Wayne State University. His dissertation topic is a content analysis of the treatment of ancient Egypt in world history textbooks. And just how far is this determined Egyptian willing to go to be classified black?
I want to carry my case all the way up to the U.S. Supreme Court if necessary.
All right, so you guys see an educator working, well, he was working on his doctorate back when this was recorded, but he mentioned the Arab conquest in the 7th century, which is the 600s AD. If you go through history, you will find that most historians agree that this is when a substantial change to what we call the Middle East and North Africa took place visually, referring to skin color wise. It became much lighter and started to resemble what it looks like now. But prior to that, as you heard him say, and you're going to hear other people say, and you're going to see the sources say, Egypt was a black nation. And the reason they needed to be white is because in the Bible, the Israelites were mistaken for Egyptians. You can't say Egyptians were dark-skinned black people and then also say that the Israelites were not. Then you would have to explain how they're being mistaken for each other in the Bible. This is a huge conspiracy. The Psalms 83 conspiracy, I do not believe, just went into slavery. There was a conspiring to not only enslave God's people, but to make God's people forget. And we're seeing that there is a clear changing and manipulation of history and race, specifically here in America. And America, at this moment in time, seems to control the thought of a lot of the world, or let me say this, a lot of people's perception of history around the world. Because most people don't do their research. A lot of them come over here to get educated, and I use that word loosely, and then they go back. Now, he said Egypt was a black nation until the 19th and 20th century, and he mentions the Hamite theory. Go watch my video on the Hamites. I cover this information about the Hamite theory, the white Hamites, and the brown skin or dark skin Caucasians. I cover that racist theory. So go check out those videos. All right. So now, this concept of North Africa and the Middle East. We're going to look at the Bible right here, and then we're going to watch two other videos that confirm what I'm saying. So let's go to Genesis chapter 10, and we're going to read verses 1 through, we'll read Genesis chapter 10 real quick, right? Because the Bible is going to be our source. And again, this is how you spot deceivers. There is no consistency when people start to deceive. They have to go address each and every individual inconsistency, and there's a lot of them when they try to deceive. So what we're going to do is we haven't gotten to the history yet. If you guys go look on my channel, there's a lot of history that we've gotten into. But in this particular video, we haven't gotten to the history yet. We listened to one man who's an educator, was going for his doctorate. He's an Egyptian, and he just spilled the beans on everything. They were trying to force him to classify as white. They wanted him to shut up. They tried to pass him over for promotions. They wanted this man to keep his mouth shut about them attempting to manipulate history via racial classification. Remember, Satan deceived the whole world. Some people think that they are beyond deception, and that is the problem with many of the apologists in the Christian church who oppose this belief. And we won't even call it a belief at this point. They oppose factual history at this point. We know that these people have been lying about race and history in order to deceive people into believing that one group of people is not who we say we are, and the other group of people is somebody who they are not. So let's read this. Genesis chapter 10, verses 1 through. Now, these are the generations of the sons of Noah, Shem, Ham, and Japheth, and unto them were sons born after the flood. If you guys go back and watch some of my videos, I showed you around the 600s AD when the Babylonian Talmud, I believe it was 600s AD, when the Babylonian Talmud was put together, that they were saying that Shem was dark, Ham was dark, and Japheth was white around the time of the Arab conquest, which were mentioned in the other video. Verse 2, the sons of Japheth, Gomer and Magog and Madai and Javan and Tubal and Meshech and Tyrus. And the sons of Gomer, Ashkenaz and Riphath and Togarmah. So now, right there, we've gone over this before, I won't go on it long. The sons of Japheth, Ashkenaz is the grandson of Japheth. He's not related to Shem. So if the Ashkenazi is the plural of Ashkenaz, and it tells you they're related to Japheth, then it should be self-explanatory. And yet you have the deceivers, and I'm gonna keep calling them what they are. They are the deceivers. They will feed you a narrative that the Israelites moved into that area and begin calling themselves Ashkenazi. So if that is true, where are the original Ashkenazi? For some reason, they can't be found. There's no historical record of a swap where the original group of Ashkenazi disappear, and suddenly the Israelites, who are really Israelites, start calling themselves Ashkenazi. Ask them for a source if they feed you this BS. We're just going to call it what it is. It's complete BS from deceivers. And if they claim it's not, make them show you the source where they get this from. And I can tell you for a fact, there is no source where they're getting this from. They are just repeating an explanation that other people have given in order to explain it away. Because it does not make sense to a rational person reading the Bible. It does not make sense. And so they have to explain it away. Tell them to show you the history of Israel calling themselves Ashkenaz, when it started, and tell them to show you what happened to the original Ashkenaz people. They can't do it. And the sons of Javan, verse 4, Elisha and Tarshish and Kittim and Dodanim, by these were the isles of the Gentiles divided in their lands, everyone after his tongue, after their families, in their nations. By who? By the descendants of Japheth, because we haven't gotten to Ham or Shem yet. So this word Gentiles, I've gone over it in my my series Unmasking the Gentiles. I believe in very specific circumstances when it's used as a proper noun. Remember, there are proper nouns and then there are improper nouns. And a proper noun is something like a name or a group of people, something like that, that has a capitalization. So I believe that when Gentile is used as a proper noun, it is specifically referring to the descendants of Japheth. And then there are other occasions where the term Gentile is used as an improper noun and it's no capitalization. It just refers to a group of people as a whole. See, I've been researching this term for quite a while. You guys can ask Tao Ministries. And my belief on it has slowly shifted from when I was in the Christian church that there were Jews and Gentiles. If you weren't a Jew, you were a Gentile. That's not what I believe any longer. I believe, again, proper nouns, improper nouns. I believe when it's used as a proper noun, it's referring to the descendants of Japheth. And then when it's used as an improper noun, it can refer to nations in general. So there is a difference there, and you have to read the book for context. And right here, it is crystal clear. It says, by these were the isles of the Gentiles divided in their land. Well, if you go back to the subject of what is being talked about, they're talking about Japheth and his descendants. So up until that point, that is the only subject, not him, Ham, not Shem. Now it gets into the sons of Ham, verse 6. And the sons of Ham, Cush and Mizraim, and Foot and Canaan. Now this is important because we were told that we were Hamites. You will find some people still saying that we are Hamites. You will find black Christians claiming that we are Hamites. Okay, so then if they're going to hold the position, and I'm going to show you guys, part of this is what helped me come to the conclusion, because when you start to be honest with yourself and you drop that silly doctrine and you start to be honest with yourself and use common sense when you read the Bible, there are a lot of beliefs you can no longer hold on to. So if you're going to say we're Hamites, you're now backed into a corner. Keep that same energy. You are backed into a corner. And the sons of Ham, Cush, Seba. I'm sorry, I went down the wrong verse. Verse 6. And the sons of Ham, Cush, Mizraim, and Foot, and Canaan. The sons of Cush, Seba, and Havilah, and Sabta, and Rama, and Sabteca, and the sons of Rama, Sheba, and Dedan. Now here we go. And Cush begat Nimrod. So Cush is a Hamite. And Cush begat Nimrod. Nimrod is a Hamite, specifically a Cushite. And in a second, I'm going to show you guys what Cush. Matter of fact, let's look now. Cushite. If you Google Cushite, Cushites right here. This is the result that comes up. 606,000 results. Cushite. Not comparable. Pertaining to the ancient people of the Horn of Africa. Historically considered the descendants of the biblical Cush. What race were the Cushites? Cush. Cushite or Cushy. I've gone over that. Ethnonyms in the Bible. This term is one of the most important terms used in the Hebrew Bible to refer to Africa and Africans. Ancient Egyptians seem to refer to black Africans in their southern border as Cushu or Cush. So, if we're all in agreement, regardless of who we think Israel is, if we're all in agreement that the Cushites were black and it refers to Africa, they're backed into a corner because you have to explain how Cush is black or African And he comes from Ham, who they say is black. And Cush has a brother, Mizraim, translated into Egypt. And they tell us that he's white, based on the classification over here. Now, I'm just pointing out, white, a person having origins in any of the original peoples of Europe, the Middle East, or North Africa. Could this be part of the racist Hamite theory that the brother was referencing in the video? I think so. Go back and watch my video on the Hamites and the racist Hamite theory, how it changed once they discovered how far along in advancement Egypt was over Europe. So let's go back. So Cushites are black, and yet Mizraim somehow is white. And then you have Put, which is Libya, and they'll say those are not black people. Those are Arab, light-skinned, Middle Eastern. And Canaan, they won't tell you Canaanites are black. So how is it that Noah has three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth? The narrative we're given is that Ham is black, Shem is Arab or Middle Eastern, and Japheth is white. But then Cush is black. And then his brother, Mizraim, is white or Middle Eastern or Arab or brown. And so is Put. And so is Canaan. It sounds crazy to a rational person who is trying to read for understanding. And then you listen to the doctrine that they're pushing in these churches. It sounds insane. And the sons of Cush, Seba and Havilah and Sabta and Rama and Sabteca, and the sons of Rama, Sheba and Dedan, and Cush begat Nimrod. He began to be a mighty one in the earth. So a Cushite began to be a mighty one in the earth. So now, one more time, let's go look at Cushites. So we looked at the definition. Let's look at some images of the Cushites. And this is the color we get. So we're told that Cushites are this color. So Ham had people this color, but magically Ham's brother Shem, who has descendants that look like Hamites, they look like two different people somehow. They get mistaken for the same people over the course of history. And yet we're told they look nothing alike. One set looks like this, and the other set looks completely different. And yet we're told to believe that they were mistaken for each other because of the way they dressed. That is ridiculous. If two of my friends come in front of me dressed exactly alike, I'm not going to mistake them for each other because of the way they're dressed. I might make fun of them for dressing like twins, but I'm not going to mistake them. They're not going to fool me. If I have a white friend and a black friend and they come dressed alike, I'm not going to say, oh, wait, I can't tell the difference between who's who. This is absurd. And yet this is the doctrine that is being taught in a lot of churches. So now he, verse 9, referring to Nimrod, he was a mighty hunter before the Lord. Wherefore, it is said, even as Nimrod, the mighty hunter before the Lord, and the beginning of his kingdom was Babel and Erech and Akkad and Calneh in the land of Shinar. See, now we have a problem if you're one of these people that say, well, Israel can't be black because they're Middle Eastern, they're from the Middle East. Well, right here in the Bible, and I've asked this question before, do we believe the Bible or do we believe doctrine? If his kingdom, the beginning of this Cushite kingdom, was Babel and Erech and Akkad and Calneh in the land of Shinar, let us look and see where the land of Shinar is. So if you just Google Shinar, the historical significance of Shinar, 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 right? Has it right over here firmly in the Middle East here, right over here, because here's the Sinai Peninsula and you'll have Israel right over in here. And you have this whole thing is what they call the Middle East. You come back to this map, which I just clicked off. You have Shinar marked right here on the map. Again, Sinai Peninsula. Here's Israel. This is the Middle East. So according to your Bible, a Cushite kingdom was located in the land of Shinar, which means that if you are a black Christian pushing that we are Hamites, if you are a black Christian pushing that we are Hamites, you have no choice but to either accept that there was a Cushite, a black African kingdom here in the Middle East, or you have to accept the nonsense doctrine and say that, oh, no, no, Hamites were really white. And so these were all white Cushites over here. And these white Cushites inhabited the Middle East. If you're not willing to say that, then you have to accept what's very clear, that there were black people in the Middle East since the days of Noah. Well, let's go back. Since the days of Nimrod, we'll start there. Since the days of Nimrod. So if Cush is the son of Ham, that would make Cush the grandson of Noah. And if Nimrod is the son of Cush, it would make Nimrod Noah's great grandson. So Noah magically had a Cushite grandson that inhabited the Middle East, but somehow all black people, according to their theory, are sub-Saharan African. Something doesn't add up. Something just doesn't add up with a lot of the doctrine and the stuff that people believe about history. Because I don't know about other people, but the Bible is my final authority. So do we believe doctrine or do we believe the Bible? So Nimrod the Cushite inhabited Shinar. He had a Cushite empire in Shinar. If we understood that about the Bible, we start from the premise that this is a Cushite empire, then we're going to see when Abraham gets called out, he is called out from a Cushite empire, a black African Hamite empire. And remember, not all Hamites are in Africa. Not all Hamites are African. The word African refers to the continent. So you can be a white African. And I first realized this in high school. I had a friend named Rupert. He was South African. And on his driver's license, it said African American, even though he was clearly white, because he was born in South Africa. His parents went there whenever they went there. I don't know when they got there, but he was born and raised in South Africa. So when he came out here to attend high school, he was born in Africa. He was white. So they put African American on his driver's license. So you can be a white African. You can be a Mexican African. Maybe. But you guys know that I'll say a Spanish African. I'll say it that way because Mexican refers to Mexico. So anyway, you can also be a Middle Eastern black person without being an African, because the term Middle East refers to the area. You can be a black Arab, because if you're born on the continent of Arabia, you are considered an Arabian or an Arab. So you can be a black Arab. You can be a black African. You can be a white Arab. You can be a brown Arab. These are geographic designations, which is why when I asked or pointed out that you don't see Arab on here, it's because it refers to, they call it the Middle East, but Arab more specifically refers to somebody born on the Arabian continent. And so they lump it all together. That includes the Sinai Peninsula, North Africa, all of that stuff. They lump it together and they say you're a white person. All right. So now let's keep going. Out of that land, talking about Shinar, went forth Asher and builded Nineveh, and the city Rehoboth and Calah, and Rezin between Nineveh and Calah, and the same is a great city. And Mizraim begat Ludim and Anamim and Lehabim and Naphtuhim and Pathrusim and Casluhim, out of whom came Philistim and Caphtorim. And Canaan beget Sidon, his firstborn. Remember, Canaan is a Hamite, the black Hamites. And Heth, which is going to be the father of the Hittites. And you'll see that Abraham gets land from them later. And the Jebusite and the Amorite and the Girgashite and the Hivite and the Arkite and the Sinite and the Arvadite and the Zemarite and the Hamathite. And afterward were the families of the Canaanites spread abroad. And the border of the Canaanites was from Sidon, as thou comest to Gerar unto Gaza, as thou goest unto Sodom and Gomorrah and Admah and Zeboim, even unto Lasha. We're not going to get into all that right now because it'll sidetrack us. But just understand, these are all brothers and nieces and nephews of Cush, who, I'm sorry, let me see, go back, Ham. So these are just, let me back up. These are the descendants of Ham. And these are all brothers, nieces, and nephews of the Cushites, cousins. These are relatives of the Cushites, the Canaanites. So if the Cushites looked how we just point out they looked, it's common sense that the Canaanites look the same. And so now you have these dark black people all the way over in Shinar, the Middle East, and now you have them all in Israel. So when they go in to conquer Canaan, they are going into a Hamitic nation. And I think a lot of that gets looked over in the Christian church because they want to stay away from race and keep this idea that Jesus was brown. He wasn't black. He wasn't white. He was brown. So now these are the sons of Ham after their families, after their tongues, in their countries and in their nations. Notice these are the sons of Ham. But when it ended with Japheth, by these were the isles of the Gentiles. Overspread. So go watch my Unmasking the Gentile study for that. Unto Shem also, the father of all the children of Eber, the brother of Japheth the elder, even to him were children born. So now we're going to get into Shem. And the children of Shem, Elam, the Elamites. If you go dig into my video on the Elamites were depicted as black. So you have Shem has a son, Elam, who's depicted as black. Shem has a brother, Ham, who is said to be the father of black people. And then in the Bible, we have Shemites and Hamites mistaken for each other. And yet we're told to believe that Ham was black and that Shem was brown or Middle Eastern. They look nothing alike visually, but if they wore the same clothes, you couldn't tell them apart. Do me a favor. Press one if this sounds crazy. If that doctrine sounds crazy to you, press two if it sounds perfectly reasonable. That you have brothers of two different colors who, if their descendants dressed alike, you couldn't tell them apart, even though they didn't visually look alike. One, if that sounds insane. Two, if you think it sounds perfectly reasonable. Do me a favor, hit that thumbs up if you haven't done so already. Hit the share button and share this video while we're live, and even after we're live, share the video. And if you have not subscribed already, do me a favor, hit that subscription button. And the children of Aram, Uz and Hul and Gether and Mash, and Arphaxad beget Salah, and Salah beget Eber, and unto Eber were born two sons. The name of one was Peleg, for in his days was the earth divided, and his brother's name was Joktan. Go check out the biblical timeline on blackhistoryinthebible.com. Go into the Israelite Apologist Handbook, and you can go to Section 5 Downloads, and you guys can see the chart I did. I think Peleg is on there now. And Joktan begat Almodad and Sheleph and Hazarmaveth and Jera and Hadaram and Uzal and Dikla and Obal and Abimel and Sheba and Ophir and Havilah and Jobab. All these were the sons of Joktan. And their dwelling was from Mesha, as thou goest unto Sephar, a mount of the east. These are the sons of Shem after their families, after their tongues, in their lands, and in their nations. Notice that up top, it did not say these are the sons of Japheth. It says by these were the isles of the Gentiles overspread. Paraphrasing. It says these are the families of the sons of Noah after their generations, in their nations. And by these were the nations divided in the earth after the flood. So now, we see the sons of Noah. We've seen the Cushites. So let's keep going, because we're going to start to see that there is no magical boundary line between what we call North Africa and what we call Sub-Saharan Africa. It is a made up piece of, I won't even call it a piece of history. It's a made up insertion into history, into the historical conversation, in order to deceive people. So when you hear these apologists talking about a North Africa and a Sub-Saharan Africa as if they're two different Africas where people didn't cross or mix, they are historically illiterate and ignorant, and they are deceiving people. I'm going to show you two videos now, and we're going to get back into this.
Currently, there's a huge debate going on about ancient Egypt, and we tried to cover a few of them here on this channel. And honestly, it's tiring because it's almost like talking about something that's nonsense, because there's archaeological findings that we have talked about. There are actual historical facts, but for some unknown reason, some people don't want to associate ancient Egypt with black. Let me show you this clip of an Egyptian brother I found on TikTok. He goes by the name of Sufi Alchemy, and let me tell you, he gathered the Egyptians that are pushing back. Watch this clip, we'll come back and discuss.
Dark-skinned people here in Egypt are of completely different features and culture than...
Assalamu alaikum, you mean the alkaline Hamitic features like myself? My skin color, my nose, my small lips, etc.? Sure, maybe the new kingdom and the Ptolemaic period pharaohs would look like me, such as Ramses III. But I'm mixed. It doesn't say anything about my forefathers. My forefathers are dark-skinned Fulani. And so was the forefathers of Ramses III and these new kingdom pharaohs, who were exposed to a lot of invasions and trades and immigrations from Europe and other parts of the world. So your argument is essentially like saying, I am brown, I have alkaline features, therefore my great-grandfather was also brown with alkaline Hamitic features. No, he wasn't. It's because my mother is white. So essentially, you deny the Old Kingdom and Middle Kingdom pharaohs, which had typical African features, and that is the part of what you say which may be interpreted as a little bit racist. Then you go about comparing modern Egyptian identity and modern Nubian identity with ancient Kemet. That's completely invalid, because we don't care about modern Egypt in terms of identities. We care about the ancient Kemites 3,000 years ago. You know, it's 3,000 years. Things have happened that time, right? I mean, you wear a hijab, you're maybe a Muslim, huh? Where the ancient Kemites, Muslim and wearing a hijab. Just trying to prove a point. That came with the Umayyad invasion when Sayyidina Usman got assassinated and the Umayyad cousins took power and invaded North Africa. People migrate tremendously, huh? Look at Dubai today. Most people in Dubai are immigrants. Look at New York, filled with immigrants. Amsterdam, filled with immigrants. The entire North Africa is filled with immigrants. I mean, the true people there are the natives. What do you think has happened to Egypt the last 3,000 years with invasions from Assyrians, Persians, Phoenicians, Romans, Greeks, you name it? So this argument that that land and nation that you today call Egypt has always been like that is completely false. Some people cite the 2017 DNA study, which actually doesn't say what people say it does, because I read the study in the Nature journal. Yeah, that's one study looking at two or three mummies. What about the 160 mummies that they didn't publish, right? What about the 1990 study that nobody talks about that showed sub-Saharan in the mummies? What about Sheikh Anta Diop's tests and so on? So you cannot just take one study and point to something. Yeah, sure, there may be people in Egypt today and Nubia today who are direct distant descendants of some pharaoh. I mean, there would have been many people in ancient Egypt, but since people have migrated there for the last 3,000 years, you can have people in West Africa also are descendants of them. You can have people in Iran who may trace their lineage back to ancient Kemal. I mean, people move. So this kind of argument, let's assume that people don't migrate. People are static only in that geographic region. They don't move. There are no wars. There are no changing of people. It's completely historyless. It's a naive argument that can be disproven as simply as just looking at your random city in Europe today. And the idea that just because I have alkaline Hamitic features, my fathers also had Hamitic features, that can change in one or two generations. Or the argument that the Egyptians today have some kind of proprietary right to history. I don't know what to say. It's ego, all I can say.
On that clip, he was responding to an Egyptian that is just angry that black people believe that there are black pharaohs and black people that used to rule ancient Egypt. And she was claiming that, like, that's why are you doing this? Like, that's not your history. This is our history. And as you heard, he made good points. Like, just because right now, after all those invasions, after mixing and after everything that happened in Egypt, you can't claim that you are the only descendant and anybody else that doesn't look like you, they are lying. We need to sue them the same way the Egyptian lawyer is suing Netflix for creating Cleopatra. This is where we have come. Like, honestly, this is really tiring, but at least there's someone that is speaking facts and actually not shy about it. Anyways, fam, let us know down below what your thoughts are about this brother's explanation. I'm Mungil Zalalem. I'll see you on the next one. Bye.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the study of antiquity and the Middle Ages. As always, I am your host, Nick Barksdale, and today we are joined once again by Dr. Rebecca Futo Kennedy, who's going to take us through a thought-provoking episode on the term sub-Saharan and the whitewashing of ancient North Africa.
Yes, I just think we should sort of like, because this idea, this like sort of continually trying to find this idea of, you know, separating out North Africa from sub-Saharan as if the Sahara was the impermeable boundary that nobody could get through is really a continually problematic point, type of argument. Particularly since we have early texts that tell us that, right, Herodotus tells us that, he says the Ethiopians and the Garamantes are indigenous to North Africa, and that, of course, the Phoenicians and the Greeks are not. But he makes it very clear that people he calls Ethiopians are indigenous to North Africa and Northwest Africa in particular, right? But they are not sub-Saharan. So I constantly, what is the obsession that people have with this idea of sub-Saharan, that whenever they ask any question, what they're trying to do is prove that sub-Saharan Africans aren't part of the ancient Mediterranean world, which we know is false. Not only do we know, of course, that people that we would call quote-unquote sub-Saharan Africans ruled Egypt before the Persians got there, among others, but that they have this continual culture that runs up and down the Nile. And we know from our ancient sources that they believed very firmly and they interacted with what in the area that they called Libya, right? So ancient geography, Herodotus separates, there's a big geographic debate in the 5th century, right? So on the one hand, we have Hecateus, who has his map of the world, and Herodotus seems to be addressing him and trying to correct him at various points in his history. But there's debate of whether there's one continent or two continents, whether everything west of the Nile is its own continent called Libya or whether it's not. One of our ancient sources actually has Europe and North Africa as one continent. Yeah, because Libya is the name that he uses for everything west of Africa, essentially, is what Herodotus uses. But it's also used at some points for the entire continent of what we call Africa. Because remember, Africa is a Roman word. It's not a Greek word. They didn't call it Africa. But yeah, this idea that there's a natural impermeable boundary that starts at the Sahara Desert, and that there's no penetration, and that everybody who has quote-unquote black skin is below that line historically, and everyone above that is somehow magically white, shows one, a real lack of knowledge of how space works and how geography functions and how mobility and movement in the ancient world functioned. It shows a very limited view of our ancient sources. Like I said, I think I said this in another clip, you know, if you're going to live by Herodotus, you got to die by Herodotus too. And if you're going to cite Herodotus for evidence of one thing, then you have to accept the fact that Herodotus says that black people, Ethiopians in our ancient parlance, Ethiopians really in our ancient parlance, are indigenous to North Africa. They're indigenous to Libya, which is his word for basically everything north of the Sahara, because as far as he's concerned, south of the Sahara is uninhabitable, right? They believe that was an uninhabited region, uninhabited zone. Nobody lived there. It was too hot. So this is, you know, you have to understand that our ancient sources were very clear that in that northern part of Africa, that's where Ethiopians lived, were indigenous to. That means there were black people there. But also the people that we refer to now as either Nubians or Cushites, those were also called Ethiopians by our Greek sources. And they were in Egypt, and they controlled Egypt for various times. And we actually have a lot of evidence, if you put Egypt into its African context in antiquity, its vision is not to the north, right? It looks to the Nile and to what we would call south, right? To the upper Nile, the upper Egypt. And in fact, the cult of Isis is actually integrated across the what we would consider the two separate kingdoms of Egypt and Nubia in antiquity, but their worship of Isis is almost identical, and they are integrated and looking to each other as early as the second millennium BCE. So we really just need to not think about this separation, which isn't even a modern separation, right? This idea of sub-Saharan is a modern racist trope that there is a magic dividing line. And it is a modern racist trope that develops back from, I'm thinking I should look, do an engram, Google engram, just to see when the term sub-Saharan first pops up in books, right? Because one of the things you can always tell is when things start to get hot and when they're not. But if you look at someone like Cuvier, who was one of the early scientists dealing with race back at sort of the turn of the 18th to 19th century, so 1801, 1802 or so, he's the guy who got Sarah Bartman's body after she died, the Hottentot Venus, and had it stuffed and had her genitals and things preserved for study. He makes clear comments about how taking the heads of mummies, which they were sort of just getting at this time out of Egypt, and her dead body and her face, and putting them together. And so here's this like 6,000 or 4,000 year old mummy, mummified head, which clearly is not in its original form, right? With her body, a model made of her, and says, look, it's very clear from looking at these two that regardless of whatever their skin color was, they're clearly different races. Because their heads are different, because this he was a craniometry guy. So if you sort of think about when is this obsession with sub-Saharan kicking in, it's kicking in when we're trying to, in a period of time where we're trying to separate off Egyptian, these ancient kingdoms that are being discovered by modern Europeans, and the sort of Black South. And actually, I'm looking at a Google engram right here that goes back to 1800. Up to 2008. I'm going to smooth it out here a little bit more. And the term doesn't start to appear in books anyway, in English, in the English language, until roughly 1978. So, why? Why does this term emerge? It has like very little life before that, and then all of a sudden in the 1960s and 1970s, I see here's an appearance of it in on communism and the Soviet Union. In sub-Saharan Africa is one of the earliest ones that I'm finding and marketing. So that divide seems to be one that has to do with economic policies and what they're viewing as economies in the modern state. It's all about development. So I think when people ask about this stuff, what they're really trying to ask, and they don't want to ask the question, so they use this phrase sub-Saharan, is, are Egyptians white like us? And they don't want to say that, because if they say things like that, then, because what happens when you sort of subsume whiteness for the entirety of North Africa, right? You want to claim the ancient civilization without modern Islam being attached to it. And then you want to separate it from blackness. That's the only reason why people use this term. There is no genetic distinction to be made here. There is no political distinction to be made here in antiquity, or in even clearly up until the modern world. If people aren't using the word, they're not making a distinction about it until they want to use it. All of Africa was a colonial playground until a certain period, and then we're going to make a distinction between the oil-rich Arab states and the mineral-rich and other resource-rich exploitable states below the Sahara that are not oil-rich states, right? Agricultural versus other. So I think anybody asking the questions about sub-Saharan and how these ideas apply to the ancient world need to stop, because they are clearly, absolutely modern impositions of ideas and ideology, and very clearly they are very recent modern impositions. And whenever people say that they want to avoid imposing modern ideologies onto ancient world, they're okay with imposing modern ideologies onto the ancient world as long as it's their modern ideologies, like the category of sub-Saharan. So I think we need to like nix that one. What you're really asking is, are they black or are they white? And the answer is neither, and both, but really neither. There's no white people running around in ancient Egypt. It's just not a category that they used. They did recognize that people had blackness, black skins, and they recognized dark skin tones, but the idea of the white is a gender category, or a category used for people who are cold burned in the very far north, or it is a category that is used for people with certain diseases. Or we actually see it in a poem by Catullus referring to Caesar for a political party affiliation, the blacks versus the whites as a sort of political thing, or a, and then we'll see it, the other place where it might be connected to these sort of politics is that it's also can be connected to chariot racing, your team, your favorite team, the greens, the reds, these are teams. The whitewashing of North Africa also ties in, you think about this thing, the idea of whitewashing North Africa, some of the loudest voices on the internet in wanting to ensure this dividing line between sub-Saharan Africa and North Africa are people of Arab descent. I'm thinking here specifically of like Nicholas Taleb, right? Because particularly in the United States, since 1910 or so, right, the people who are called Syrian get to be white, right? So they're categorized technically, people from the Middle East are categorized as white because of this 1910 or 1919 law that categorized them as white, but they don't get to live the experience of being white in America because they're Muslim. So, but I think there's this bind into people who have recent access to whiteness, particularly in the United States, but also in the Middle East where there is anti-blackness, severe anti-blackness, that they want to make sure that they can make that harsh dividing line, right? And they are some of the loudest voices. And so whitewashing of the Middle East is an ongoing long-term historical process. But in terms of how Europeans and Americans are doing it, Europeans are doing it primarily as a way to lay claim to the antiquities of Egypt and Libya, which of course it's colonized by the Romans. And so you find Roman sites all over Libya and other places. But then in the United States, it has to do with the fact that people who at the time were classified as Syrian, but what we really mean is people of Middle East descent or people of Arab descent from the Middle East, they got classified legally as white. And so think about what that looks like as someone like me, who is a white person, right? A European descent white person, saying to someone who is like Taleb or something that North Africa isn't white, right? Or more, even more important is that this is actually what happened during the Mary Beard Taleb debate, which was Beard was like, they weren't white. You know, Libya and these places are not white spaces. This is not a concept that exists in the ancient world. And Taleb comes after her and says, who are you, colonizer, to kick me out of whiteness? Right. But it's all this obsession of wanting to participate in this dominant identity group that is called whiteness, which has no roots in antiquity and has no roots even really in much modernity outside of, I mean, it's really a creature of the U.S., though it appears in European texts earlier. We're the people who sort of run with it and turn it into this idea. And what we actually mean by white is dominant. We don't mean anything to do with our actual skin color.
All right, so you guys heard those two videos. Do me a favor, hit that thumbs up if you haven't done so already, and make sure you share this video. So you heard those two videos. Now, the reason I played those videos is so that you could see a different group of people saying the same thing that we're saying. Because see, Dr. Brown, in one of his latest shows, tried to push the narrative that we're manipulating the Bible, even though there are other people saying that, no, this is historically accurate. And these are the original people. They didn't look like the people who are there now. And yet you have these deceivers like Dr. Brown and some of the other apologists. They want you to believe that the black Hebrew Israelites, or as he called them, the radical black Hebrew Israelites, are using the Bible out of context and misusing it to prove race. Well, what about the history? This is why they don't want to address the history, because it makes it easier to deceive people when they don't get into the history. It makes it easier to deceive people when they teach nonsense doctrine and say, well, this is what the Bible teaches. Well, the Bible seems to say something different when we go and look at it. When we start asking common sense questions, none of it makes sense. So now I'm going to read you, we're going to look at a source. And this source is Anacalypsis. Shout out to Tazara, who went over a few pages in this source in the last video I showed of his. And I'm going to go over a few different pages. We were actually working on something at the same time out of the same book, and we didn't know it. I didn't know because he sent me the video. I didn't know he was going to send me a video. He sent me the video, and then when I saw what he was working on, I was like, wow, I'm actually working on that same book, but in a different area. So, yeah, this is Anacalypsis, an attempt to draw aside the veil of the Sayyidic Isis, or an inquiry into the origin of languages, nations, and religions, Volume 1, published in 1836. Now, remember, they want you to believe, and by they, I mean the apologists, specifically the Christian apologists that are against anything black having to do with Israel in the Bible, the racist apologists. So they want you to believe that we are misusing the Bible to come to the conclusion that Jesus was black and that Israel was black. They want you to believe that this is what they call Black Hebrew Israelite doctrine. Some people will say this is camp doctrine. And yet when we start going through these sources, as you heard the lady mention and the brother mention, these people are historically ignorant. And I also call them historically illiterate. I've shown you guys plenty of sources. This is the first time I believe I'm mentioning this source, but Godfrey Higgins. So now, real quick, we're just going to look at who Godfrey Higgins was. This is a picture of Godfrey Higgins right here. You can see he is not black. He's not a Black Hebrew Israelite. He is clearly European. So Godfrey Higgins, real quick, I'm just going to read this part right here. I'm not going to get into all this other stuff. Right here, it says Godfrey Higgins, January 30th, 1772 to August 9th, 1833 in Cambridge. Cambridge is going to come up a lot, and I love it because people claim that they're, you know, they've debunked the Cambridge source. Shout out to Kobe the Clown. Claiming that they've debunked the Cambridge source. And yet here we go again with somebody else associated with Cambridge. And I've shown other sources that mention Cambridge, reference Cambridge, are published by Cambridge, associated with Cambridge. Cambridge comes up a lot in this historical search for information. So now, Godfrey Higgins was an English magistrate and landowner, a prominent advocate for social reform, historian, and antiquarian. He wrote concerning ancient myths. His book, Anacalypsis, was published posthumously, so after death, in which he asserts a commonality among various religious myths, which he traces back to the supposed lost religion of Atlantis. He has been termed a political radical, reforming county magistrate, and idiosyncratic historian of religions. So now, he studied religions. And I will go down here, and he does say something that I find interesting. And this is why I find it interesting. I've been studying this topic since around 2014. So I'm almost a decade in on researching this specific area of history. And I find it interesting that a lot of these newcomers who've been at it for a couple of months or a week or maybe even a year or two or three, they act like they are experts. They make false claims. They quote false history. They say, well, we can't find it, so it doesn't exist. They make these claims. And this is how you can tell somebody's an amateur is when they're doing that. So here's what he says about writing on mythology. It says he developed a regimen to study the meaning of life and origin and wrote, I came to a resolution to devote 6 hours a day to this pursuit for 10 years. Instead of 6 hours daily for 10 years, I believe I have upon the average applied myself to it for nearly 10 hours daily for almost 20 years. So he was going to do 6 hours a day for 10 years. He did 10 hours a day for 20 years. But listen to what he says about the information. In the first 10 years of my research, I may fairly say I found nothing which I sought for. So he says for the first decade, he didn't find anything he was looking for. And yet I've been at this a decade, and it's easier because we have the internet and everything's connected now. You can get access to information so much faster. So he spent a decade looking for information that he couldn't find. People spend weeks, months, and they act like they've uncovered everything, that they know everything. They've unlocked all the history. They've debunked all the articles. They know more than all the universities in Cambridge and this guy right here. But listen, I'm going to read the rest. In the first 10 years of my search, I may fairly say I found nothing which I sought for. In the latter part of the 20, the quantity of matter has so crowded in upon me that I scarcely know how to dispose of it. So first 10 years, nothing. Second 10 years, overwhelming abundance of information that he didn't know what to do with. So let's come over here to Anacalypsis, and I'm going to read this section right here. This right here is page 751. The links will be in the description. Click the link. It'll take you to the page on blackhistoryinthebible.com, and that will have all the sources that I use in this video, including the links to the videos I played. So now, this is what he says in his book, Anacalypsis. Again, page 751. I'm going to read this middle section here. I have formally observed that I learnt from Mr. Salome. Let me see if I can enlarge this anymore. All right, here we go. From Mr. Salome that the Lascars spoke Hebrew. So real quick, let's look at the Lascars. I wouldn't pull this up because I don't want us to miss anything as to what's going on. The Lascars spoke Hebrew. If you Google Lascar, it looks like these men right here. These are Lascars. Do these look like Europeans to you? Do me a favor. If you think these are dark-skinned Caucasians, press 1. If you do not think these are dark-skinned Caucasians, press 2. For dark-skinned Caucasians, press 1. If you don't think they're dark-skinned Caucasians, press 2. All right, real quick. Let me close this down and I'll read this. A Lascar was a sailor or militiaman from the Indian subcontinent. So now we're gonna talk about India in a second, because it's gonna bring us to Claudius Buchanan. So a military man from the Indian subcontinent, Southeast Asia, the Arab world, British Somaliland, or other lands east of the Cape of Good Hope, who was employed on European ships from the 16th century until the mid 20th century. So from the 1500s to the mid 1900s. Interesting. They spoke Hebrew and they were employed by Europeans during the transatlantic slave trade. The Cape of Good Hope, a rocky headland on the Atlantic coast of the Cape Peninsula in South Africa. Okay, so now we see the Lascars here. We see what they look like. So let's read. I formally observed that I learned from Mr. Salome that the Lascars spoke Hebrew. Another Jewish friend met with two of the black Lascars from the Malabar Cohen in London, who were both Jews and spoke the Hebrew or Chaldee language. They were quite black and had in every respect the Lascar character, not at all like the Jews of the West, from whom they are easily distinguishable. So now, let's real quick go back to what the Bible said about Jews and or Israelites and Egyptians being mistaken for each other. He's saying that these people are quite black, not at all like the Jews of the West, and they are easily distinguishable. People could tell people apart based on skin color. He's saying these Jews don't even look like these other Jews. But yet they will feed you this narrative in the Christian community that these other people who did not look alike kept getting mistaken for each other because their clothes were different. Their clothes were the same. And here you have a guy saying, no, they're English, easily distinguishable one from another, even though they're both Jews. They can tell the Jews apart, but for some reason in the Bible, they can't tell Jew from Egyptian, but now they could tell Jew from Jew. It doesn't make sense, the narrative that they want to push. So they were quite black and had in every respect the Lascar character, not at all like the Jews of the West, from whom they were whom they are easily distinguishable. They accompanied my friend the English Jew to his synagogue. If the black Jews were a colony from the West like the white ones, they would have been white like the white ones. It is out of the question. Listen carefully. Again, this book was published in 1836. 1836. Where is it at? Over here. Let me see. It is out of the question to pretend that the difference of climate can have made them black. People aren't stupid. Y'all remember when the apologists came out and tried to say it was climate, they were black because of climate? Even in 1836, this guy is saying it is out of the question to pretend, make believe, fake, lie. It is out of the question to pretend that the difference of climate can have made them black, because they are black in the country above the peninsula, where there is little or no difference between the latitude, latitude and that of Western Syria. They cannot be supposed to be blacks converted to Judaism. This is the narrative that the apologists are trying to push, that the black ones are converts. But let's keep reading. They cannot be supposed to be blacks converted to Judaism because the Jews never made proselytes. In this, as in other matters, retaining their Brahmin habits, they cannot have come from the 10 tribes as nonsensically pretended, because they are Jews. And they're talking about Judah, Levi, Benjamin, and a little bit of Simeon. And this is going to be consistent. So they didn't come from the 10 tribes. He's saying they're part of the southern tribes. We're going to keep reading. They cannot have come from the 10 tribes as nonsensically pretended, because they are Jews, having the Jewish or Chaldee language and not the Samaritan. The Jews of Western Syria in the time of Jesus Christ were not black, but there are great numbers of black infant Christ and black crucifixes in Italy. And Christ was a Jew. Was he of the black tribe? Indeed, I believe that the Christ, whose black icon I saw in Italy, was, and I believe that he came to Italy when his black mother arrived at Laredo from Syria, Stream, I think that's what this is, from Saturnia, or Regina Saturnalia, or Palestina, even before the foundation of the Rome of Romulus, that a colony of white Jews fleeing from the Romans should take refuge among their ancient countrymen seems not improbable. Nor does it seem improbable that the black Jews, in some instances, should have acquired Pentateuchs from their white neighbors, for though perhaps nothing would induce them to change their religion, yet they would easily be led to suppose themselves of the same religion as the Western Jews, which fundamentally they were, in the same manner and for similar reasons as those which induced the Western Christian to believe the, I think that's the Cretans of Malabar, to be of theirs. But yet I think another cause will be found for it presently. Now, this is over 800 pages. I'm not going to read the whole source. You'll hear Covey the Clown say, Dante didn't read the whole source. That's what clowns do. But yeah, if you guys go back and you guys can read this whole source yourself. So now there's a few things I want to point out through here. A few things I already pointed out. A few things I'm going to point out. Now, he's saying they're not converts, but they are Jews. It's not because of climate. And so he points out the difference between the white Jews and the black Jews, which we're going to come back to, which is kind of why I just kept going over that part, because we're going to get more in depth into that as we go through some of these sources. So now he mentions the black Jews. He gives us the Lascars, which we can look at. So we know that when they come in and some of the apologists have made this argument that black doesn't mean black. And, you know, they try to find a way to explain away black every time. They don't try to explain away white, but they do try to explain away black. And then, which is why I'm glad that he gave the Lascars as an example, because now you can't explain it away. But we've also found instances where white doesn't mean white, and that there were actually black albinos being referred to as white people. And that's something that the apologists deceptively hid from people or just didn't know about. And if they didn't know about it, they should have just kept quiet on the issue. But we'll see the deception. So anyway, right here. Indeed, I believe that the Christ, whose black icon I saw in Italy, was... And I believe that he came to Italy when his black mother arrived at Laredo. So he believes in a black Christ. He said Christ had a black mother. He's saying that Mary was black. And he talks about the icons. So what are icons? I went ahead and pulled them up so you guys can see what he's referring to. The Black Virgin Mary. So this idea of a black Virgin Mary, you can see these all over the place. And people will say, oh, no, these are rusted and the rust built up. But you can see these all over the world. There are black virgin icons and paintings. And I'm not going through showing the modern stuff. But you can see these all over the world. And yet people will make the claim that a lot of this is just made up. They will say it's black Hebrew Israelite ideology. This is camp doctrine. But we can see here that this concept of a black Virgin Mary is a thing. Now, if we want to be historically consistent, if Christ is black, he would have a black mother, which is what this man is saying, who published his book, and or the book was published after he died posthumously. So the 1836, this book was published, which is after he died, which means before 1836, he believed that Christ was black. He believed that Christ had a black mother. So if Christ had a black mother, that would mean her mother, too, would also be black. So when we talk about historical consistency, it's important to dot your I's and cross your T's. So you go digging. And the reason that we have to go digging further than just Christ is because, see, if we can say that Mary was black, then we know that Christ is black. And so they want to stay away from that. But see, we can't prove that Mary was black. But we do have something else, which, again, if you're being truthful about history, your history should be consistent. So if we come over here to OrthoChristian.com, Orthodox Christianity, the conception by righteous Anna of the Most Holy Mother of God, commemorated on December 9th. Now, I'm going to read this. It's short. I'm going to read it. Now, this is from 2016, the Orthodox Church in America. I'll click. Let me open this link real quick. The Orthodox Church in America. Let me see about the OCA. Here we go. Let me see if they have any just quick about. Anyway, the Holy Synod, this administration, the supreme canonical authority in the church, and includes voting members, all the diocesan bishops of the church. The metropolitan is the ex officio chairman of the synod. Their information, encyclicals, and statements are located here. So anyway, you can get into all this stuff. They don't just have a quick, here we go. Right here, the Orthodox Church in America's departments provides a wealth of ministry resources in an effort to expand the church's efforts in essential areas of church life. The departments produce appropriate materials, offer a wide variety of seminars and workshops, serve as a clearinghouse for the implementation of new ministries and the expansion of those already in existence. You guys can go read all of this. The mission of the Orthodox Church in America, the local autocephalous Orthodox Christian Church, is to be faithful in fulfilling the commandment of Christ to go into all the world and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit. So now they are a Christian organization. Rewind. All right. So this is on their website, Ortho christian.com. This right here is OCA.org. But yeah, they are a Christian organization. Now let's read this. Now notice the depiction right here. Let's see, I'm making it bigger. Notice the depiction right here. Do me a favor, press 1 if you think these are dark-skinned Caucasians. Press 2 if you do not think these are dark-skinned Caucasians. So, I just want to point this out. This is what they look like. Remember, the apologist will tell you that Revelation is not about the skin color of Christ, even though we could read he has bronze skin. His feet and hands were bronze. We can see this. We know from history that it makes sense that he would be a black man. We've gone over that, so I'm going to read this real quick. Saint Anna, the mother of the Virgin Mary. Pause. This is what we're talking about, black. This black woman right here. Saint Anna, the mother of the Virgin Mary. So if we say Christ is black, and this guy in 1836 said Mary was black, and then we come over here to an Orthodox Christian website who are Christians, and they're saying that Mary's mother is black. See, historically consistent. When you're not trying to deceive people, it's historically consistent. It says, Saint Anna, the mother of the Virgin Mary, was the youngest daughter of the priest Nathan from Bethlehem. So wait, Nathan was black? If this is how his daughter looked, descended from the tribe of Levi. You mean Levi? That tribe that was in Africa that Moses came out of. She married Saint Joachim, who was a native of Galilee. So this is Saint Joachim. This is Saint Anna. These are the parents of the Virgin Mary, which means if Mary's parents look like this, Christ likely looked like this, which is why in Revelation we see that they use similes for the color of his legs and hands, or his feet and hands. For a long time, Saint Anna was childless, but after 20 years, through the fervent prayer of both spouses, an angel of the Lord announced to them that they would be the parents of a daughter who would bring blessings to the whole human race. The Orthodox Church does not accept the teaching that the Mother of God was exempted from the consequences of ancestral sin, death, corruption, sin, etc., at the moment of her conception by virtue of the future merits of her son. Only Christ was born perfectly holy and sinless, as Saint Ambrose of Milan teaches in the chapter 2 of his commentary on Luke. The Holy Virgin was like everyone else in her mortality and in being subject to temptation, although she committed no personal sins. See, I don't agree with all this doctrine. She was not a deified creature removed from the rest of humanity. I think they're trying to separate themselves from the Catholic Church in this doctrine. If this were the case, she would have not have been truly human, and the nature that Christ took from her would not have been truly human either. If Christ does not truly share our human nature, then the possibility of our salvation is in doubt. The conception of the Virgin Mary by Saint Anna took place at Jerusalem. The many icons depicting the conception by Saint Anna show the Most Holy Theotokos trampling the serpent, or Theotokos trampling the serpent underfoot. In the icon of Saint Joachim and Anna are usually depicted with hands folded in prayer. Their eyes are also directed upward, and they contemplate the Mother of God, who stands in the air with outstretched hands. Under her feet is an orb encircled by a serpent, symbolizing the devil, which strives to conquer all the universe by its power. Let me see. These are also icons. There are also icons in which Saint Anna holds the Most Holy Virgin in her left arm as an infant. On Saint Anna's face is a look of reverence. A large ancient icon painted on canvas is located in the village of Minkovesta in the Dubinsk district of Volnia Diocese. From ancient times, this feast was especially venerated by pregnant women in Russia. Troparion Tone 4, not sure what that is. Today, the bonds of barrenness are broken. God has heard the prayers of Joachim and Anna. He has promised them beyond all their hopes to bear the maiden of God, by whom the uncircumscribed one was born as mortal man. He commanded an angel to cry to her, "Rejoice, O full of grace, the Lord is with you." Kontakion Tone 2. problem. Today you have shown forth. Today the universe rejoices, for Anna has conceived the Theotokos through God's dispensation, for she has brought forth the one who is to bear the ineffable word. The Orthodox Church in America, 12/13/2016. So anyway, this is how Anna is depicted. You guys can go look up Saint Anna, do your own research on Saint Anna, but she is depicted as a black woman. She is the mother of Mary, which would mean that Mary was likely the same color as her parents, which means Christ is likely the same color as his parent. This right here is historically consistent. All right, let's keep going. All right, so now we're going to jump over here to Hannah Adams. The history of the Jews from the destruction of Jerusalem to the present time. Hannah Adams, interesting lady. Now, we're going to get some details that I think are absent from a lot of the historical discussions. I've gone over this before. A lot of people have come to the conclusion that those taken into the transatlantic slave trade are Judah. And just the tribe of Judah specifically. But we have to understand that the southern kingdom, Judah, was never just Judah. It included Levi, Benjamin, and some of Simeon. And not just that, it did include small numbers of people from other tribes. And we're going to see this. That may sound crazy or off to some people who haven't studied the full history. But remember, they were cursed as a nation. This is before the splitting of the southern and northern kingdom. So they were cursed as a nation in Deuteronomy 28 if they disobeyed. It wasn't split into, well, only this is going to happen to the northern kingdom or southern kingdom in Deuteronomy 28. So you're going to find that there are remnants. I'm talking about families or small groups. I'm not talking about massive amounts of people from the other tribes. I'm talking about small groups and remnants. But you will see that some of Simeon were part of the northern tribes, but some of Simeon left with Judah. Levites left with Judah. And I promise you that there were some Benjamites and Levites and Judites and Simeonites that went with the northern kingdom. And we're talking about small pockets, not the whole nation. So now, let's look through this. It wasn't published in 2009. The original was published before then. I actually pulled up, let me see. Right here, 1818, The History of the Jews by Hannah Adams. This is when it was originally published, 1818. But let me show you Hannah Adams. This is her. Just so you can see what Hannah Adams looks like. She's not black. She's not a black Hebrew Israelite. She doesn't belong to a camp. And we're going to use Hannah Adams because now we're going to trace some stuff backwards. Real quick, I'll read this first top part. Not this whole top part. Just right here. Hannah Adams was an American author of books on comparative religion and early United States history. She was born in Medfield, Massachusetts, and died in Brookline. Adams was the first woman in the U.S. who worked professionally as a writer. So first professional writer, and she covered comparative religion. So now, this is what Hannah Adams looked like. This is when her book was published, 1818. Now, we're going to read pages 366 through 369, and I'm just going to point out a few things. I'm not going to stay long on this because there's a couple more sources to get through before we wrap this up. Let's see. We'll start here. A late author informs us that a Catholic clergyman who had recently quitted Spain after a residence there of 12 years spontaneously related to him the following circumstances that the Spaniards universally believe there are among them a great number of concealed Jews, chiefly in the trading classes and some among the clergy, and that the captain of a packet with whom he was windbound at Coruna informed him he had met with many persons in France, South America, and elsewhere who had freely confessed to him they were Jews. though they had lived long in Spain as Catholics, and that one of these persons had been outwardly a Catholic clergyman and really in orders as such. So there were Jews pretending to be Catholics. Some of y'all have heard of the conversos. So we're gonna keep going into this. And we're going to see that all this stuff ties together. Even as late as the close of the 18th century, any person believed to be a Jew, whether he had previously appeared as a Catholic or not, would still be seized in Spain if discovered by the Inquisition. So the Inquisition, again, Jews, Muslims, everybody had to convert to Christianity. The following is an extract from the decree of the Spanish government. So this is an extract directly from a decree. The decree itself would be a primary source. This is quoting a primary source, the decree itself. The following is an extract from a decree of the Spanish government promulgated against the Jews, July 22nd, 1800. This is in quotes. His Majesty ordered his ministers to deliver no passports to Jews intending to enter Spain, whatever might be the motive of their journey, and whether they be desirous or not of making any stay in the kingdom. He enjoined the governors of the frontiers to prevent their entrance into the Spanish territories and to expel all who may be discovered in it. This is the 1800s. This is 65 years. This is July 22nd, 1800s. 65 years before slavery ended in the U.S., Jews were banished from Spain. They weren't allowed to enter, and those that were in it were being kicked out of it. So now, for a long time, the laws of this monarchy have forbidden all Jews to attempt a transit or an establishment in the dominions of His Majesty. Remember, this is the Inquisition is still going on. 65 years before the end of slavery, the Spanish Inquisition is still going on. I've told y'all before that I thought the KKK was an extension of the Spanish Inquisition. It just carried over here into America. The lynchings, the slavery, all that stuff leading up to the KKK was a continuation of the Spanish Inquisition. And now we can see from this document that even 65 years before the end of slavery in America, the Spanish Inquisition was still in full effect. So give me a one if you think that it's coincidental that some of the same practices occurring during the Inquisition happened to slaves in America. Or give me two if you don't think it's coincidental. One, if you think it's a coincidence. Two, if you don't think it's a coincidence. The Spanish Inquisition overlaps with the transatlantic slave trade. For those of you who don't have a proper context of history, I'll say it again. The Spanish Inquisition overlaps with the transatlantic slave trade. They were deporting Jews to West Africa during the Inquisition, the Spanish and Portuguese Inquisitions. They were deporting Jews, black Jews, to Africa. I think I just said America, but Africa. And then from there in West Africa, where they deported these Jews, magically we have the transatlantic slave trade occur. And people say, wait, you guys have nothing to do with those Jews that got taken into West Africa. It's just a coincidence. It's coincidence that they were moving them there on ships and then they moved them somewhere else on ships. Coincidence. All right, so. Let's see. For a long time, the laws of this monarchy have forbidden all the Jews to attempt a transit for an establishment in the dominions of His Majesty. A late transgression calls for a rigorous enforcement of these laws. The Spanish and Portuguese Jews claim their descent from the tribe of Judah. I'll read this one more time. The Spanish and Portuguese Jews claim their descent from the tribe of Judah and found these pretensions on the supposition which prevails among them that many of their ancestors removed or were sent into Spain at the time of the Babylonian captivity. So these Jews who claimed to be of the tribe of Judah, the Spanish and Portuguese Jews who claimed to be of the tribe of Judah, say they were sent into Spain at the time of the Babylonian captivity. Remember, this is published in 1818. So Nebuchadnezzar would have sent them into Spain at the time of the Babylonian captivity. This is important. And we're gonna keep reading, but I want you guys to keep that in mind. They were sent into Spain during the time of the Babylonian captivity. Again, published in 1818. In consequence of this supposed superiority, they, till very lately, would not by intermarriage or otherwise incorporate with their brethren of other nations. So they remained separate. This is important. See, the small details are important when you start to get into history. The devil is in the details. They had separate synagogues. And if a Portuguese Jew, even in England or Holland, married a German Jewess, he was immediately expelled from the synagogue, deprived of every civil and ecclesiastical right, and ejected from the body of the nation. So even if you were a Spanish or Portuguese Jew in Holland or England or Germany or wherever, and you married a Jew of a different color, you were expelled from the entire nation. So they remained separate. This is important, and I'm going to show you why in a second. A late instance has occurred of a Jew in Berlin who, having married the daughter of a Portuguese physician, the parents of the girl went in mourning as for the death of a relation. The manners of the Portuguese Jews differ from the rest of the nation and are more polished. Remember, these are the ones sent into Spain during the Babylonian captivity. They have nothing peculiar in their dress. The opulent among them vie with the other nations of Europe in refinement, elegance, and show, and differ from them in worship only. In Portugal, the name of a Jew is a term of such high reproach that the government found it necessary to enact a law which forbade any person to call another by that appellation. So they weren't allowed to be identified as Jews. They started to erase their identity. They weren't allowed to be referred to as what they were. And yet you will have people say, well, how did they forget? I'm going to show you how this ties into Black people in America in a minute. And Cambridge is going to be used. In Portugal, all right, read that. If a man who is styled a Jew to his face stabs the offender, the law does not condemn him. And trifling as this regulation may appear, it has produced beneficial effects. The Jews in Portugal remain separated from the Germans and retain their ritual usages, but government has destroyed the obstacles which the institution of Portugal opposed to their marriage with the Germans. So the Portuguese Jews are separate. They say they were sent into Spain during the time of the Babylonian captivity. Now, let's read some of these notes right here, because the notes have some interesting information in them as well. Let's see. All right, we'll start here. Where are the notes? Okay, we'll start here. The Jews are said to have been numerous in the Spanish and Portuguese monasteries and nunneries, and that many of the priests, inquisitors, and even bishops are of Hebrew origin. Modern Universal History, Volume 13, page 357. Come down to the notes right here. Gisborne, on the Christian Religion, page 110, it says, it is said that in about 1755, when a terrible earthquake in Lisbon destroyed 30,000 of the inhabitants, the Portuguese believed that the mercy of God might be obtained by burning some Jews. They started human sacrifices and they started burning Jews. Interesting that they were lynching and burning over here in America as well. Started burning Jews and other heretics in what they call the Ato de Fe, or act of faith. They started human sacrifices to God. These are the Europeans starting sacrifices to God, sacrificing God's people to him to appease him. This is what they thought Christianity was about. They called it the atta de fe, the act of faith. It appears that the Jews have no accurate deduction of their descent or genealogy. See, over time, things begin to be lost. And people say, well, where in the Bible does it say you will lose your identity or you'll forget? It says you will cease from your heritage. It says they will remember themselves. They will remember me. In order to remember, you have to forget. It appears that the Jews have no accurate deduction of their descent or genealogy. They suppose that they are in general of the tribe of Judah and Benjamin, with some among them of the tribe of Levi. So now Hannah Adams is pointing out that the Spanish and Portuguese Jews, though these Portuguese Jews who were deported into Spain during the Babylonian captivity, say that they're Judah, Benjamin, and Levi. They don't have their complete genealogy, but they know they come from those tribes. Right here, Gregor, who mentions the fact, informs us that it was communicated to him by a learned German Jew. Essay on the Reformation of Jews is citing the sources. So now we're going to go to the next source. Now remember, the Portuguese Jews stayed separate. They were deported into Spain during the time of the Babylonian captivity, which goes back to Nebuchadnezzar. These are going to be important pieces of information, and this was published in 1818. So now we're going to take a look at the works of the Reverend Claudius Buchanan. This is published in 1812, 6 years before the Hannah Adams source, 6 years before 1818. This is the Reverend Claudius Buchanan. And this is what he looks like. For those of you who have not seen Claudius Buchanan, notice that I'm showing you all Europeans. Notice I'm showing you people of other races, with the exception of the Egyptian man in the first video. I'm showing you people of different ethnicities and skin colors talking about the same thing. Black people in the Middle East, or what we would call the Middle East. There is a clear historical black presence in the Middle East. And yet, when we come over to the Census Bureau, if you're part of the original peoples of Europe, the Middle East, or North Africa, you're classified as white. Remember, Satan deceived the whole world. Satan deceived the whole world. So now, let's come over here. This is the works of Reverend Claudius Buchanan. This is interesting because, again, 6 years before Hannah Adams says that the Portuguese Jews said they were deported to Spain during the Babylonian captivity, which would be Nebuchadnezzar. And now they end up in Portugal. And those who have been following the research of myself, Teo, Benaiah Israel, and others, you know that they were deported from Portugal into West Africa, Sao Tome, Principe, Angola, Nigeria, Ghana, Benin, Togo, that whole area, all up and down in there. They were in Mali and Timbuktu, everywhere over there. Lamlim, there's a bunch of places, if you start to study this old map, the Jews all over West Africa, and they disappeared during the transatlantic slave trade. It's not a coincidence. Press one if you think it's a coincidence that they disappeared during the transatlantic slave trade. Press two if you don't think it's a coincidence. All right, so now I'm going to read this from Claudius Buchanan, The Black Jews. This is page 136, and I'm going to read through page 138. Probably not through the whole page of 138, but anyway. So, it is only necessary to look at the countenance of the black Jews to be satisfied that their ancestors must have arrived in India many ages before the white Jews. So, he's saying the black Jews got there first in India. Their Hindu complexion. Let's go back to the Lascars. Who were the Lascars? Lascar was a sailor, a militiaman from the Indian subcontinent. And remember, he said they spoke Hebrew in the Anacalypsis. Said they spoke Hebrew. These are the black Jews of India. And now, and that was published 1836. The Anacalypsis, if I recall, let me make sure. Hold on, here it is. Yeah, 1836 by Godfrey Higgins. He refers to the Lascars. Let me go back. Anyway, yeah, he refers to the Lascars, and then we let me get over here. Let me make sure. I don't want to jump ahead of myself. All right. So we're back to Clive Buchanan. He refers to the Lascar. He refers to the black Jews who arrived in India many ages before the white Jews. All right. Their Hindu complexion and their very imperfect resemblance to the European Jews indicate that they have been detached from the parent stock in Judea many ages before the Jews in the West, and that there have been intermarriages with families not Israelitish. I had heard that those tribes which had passed the Indus have assimilated so much to the customs and habits of the countries in which they live that they may be sometimes seen by a traveler without being recognized as Jews. So they have become integrated. Now, if you guys remember, I covered a source that was published in 1868, and it talked about those Jews that had migrated into Africa had picked up the ways of the people whom they lived around, and they became indistinguishable from the people around them. And that was in Africa, and from a source from 1868. And see, we have one here in 1812 saying the same thing happened in India. They started to assimilate with the people around them. Now we can understand better why God says, do not learn the ways of the heathen. Don't envy their ways. Don't learn their ways. I'm paraphrasing, but he says, be ye separate. Don't learn their ways. And so we see two different accounts on two different continents. We have the Asia continent or the subcontinent of India, and we have Africa. So when the Jews went into Africa, started to learn the ways, they became indistinguishable from the people. And when they came over here to India, they learned the ways and they became indistinguishable from the people. There's historical consistency. It says, I had heard that those tribes which had passed the Indus have assimilated so much to the customs and habits of the countries in which they live that they may be sometimes seen by a traveler without being recognized as Jews. Read Lamentations. They are not known in the streets. In the interior towns of Malabar, I was not always able to distinguish the Jew from the Hindu. I hence perceived how easy it may be to mistake the tribes of Jewish descent among the Afghans and other nations in the northern parts of Hindostan. The white Jews look upon the black Jews as an inferior race and not of a pure caste, which plainly demonstrates that they do not spring from a common stock in India. Now, here's where we get into some interesting stuff. So the white Jews and the black Jews are at odds. And remember, we just read in Hannah Adams, if they get married, the Portuguese Jews, they remain separate, and if they were to intermarry with other Jews, they were kicked out of the nation as a whole. And that's Hannah Adams talking about what's going on in Portugal. Here we have Claudius Buchanan talking about in India, the white Jews and the black Jews did not get along. There's something going on to where the white Jews and the black Jews remain separate. I was going to read this other source to you guys, but I did not. Let me see. Where is it at? Here. This right here goes into, I'm not going to read this source, but I'll put the link so you guys can read it yourself. But it talks about the black Khazars, which were Jews, versus the white Khazars, which were converts. And they did not intermix. They remained separate. So this source is actually covers the Sun Black tribe of Manasseh. I have read it before, but I'll have it in there so you can read it yourself. All right. The black Jews communicated to me much interesting intelligence concerning their brethren, the ancient Israelites in the East. Traditional indeed in its nature, but in general illustrative of true history. They recounted the names of many other small colonies, residents of northern India, Tartary, and China, and gave me a written list of 65 places I conversed with those who had lately visited many of these stations and were about to return again. The Jews have a never-ceasing communication with each other in the East. Their families indeed are generally stationary, being subject to despotic princes. But the men move much about in a commercial capacity, and the same individual passed through many extensive countries. So that then anything interesting to the nation of the Jews takes place, the rumor will pass rapidly through all Asia. I inquired concerning their brethren, the 10 tribes. They said it was commonly believed among them that the great body of Israelites are to be found in Chaldea and in the countries contiguous to it, being the very first places whither they were first carried into captivity. That some few families had migrated into regions more remote, as to Cochin and Rajapur in India, and to other places yet further to the east, but that the bulk of the nation, though now much reduced in number, had not to this day removed 2,000 miles from Samaria. Among the black Jews, I could not find many copies of the Bible. They informed me that in certain places of the remote dispersion, their brethren have but some small portions of the scriptures, and that the prophetical books were rare, but that they themselves, from the vicinity to the white Jews, have been supplied from time to time with the whole of the Old Testament. From these communications, I plainly perceive the important duty which now devolves on Christians possessing the art of printing to send to the Jews in the East copies of the Hebrew scriptures and particularly of the prophetical books. If only the prophecies of Isaiah and Daniel were published among them, the effect might be great. They do not want the law so much, but the prophetical books would appear among them with some novelty, particularly in a detached form, and could easily be circulated through the remotest parts of Asia. All right, so you have the black Jews. He refers to them as the ancient Jews. You have the European Jews. He's saying that they remained separate. The white Jews looked down upon the black Jews. Hannah Adams said that the black Jews or the Spanish Jews, the Portuguese Jews, wouldn't mix with other Jews. All right, so we're going to keep going and look at another source. We're going to tie all this together. Mm-hmm. All right, so now we're going to look at a treatise on physical geography comprising hydrology, geognosy, geology, meteorology, botany, zoology, and anthropology, published in 1851. We're just going to come down here. We could read all of this. I remember before the other guy said it was absurd to pretend that the difference in color were due to climate. But we're going to read this. This is page 297, Treatise on Physical Geography, published in, was it 18, what, 51. All right, it says, they are all unquestionably of one race. And yet, as we move from around the lake southward, they become darker and darker. Till the plains of Orinoco and the Amazon, they are nearly black. While on the cool and humid shores of the Pacific, they are found fairer than many Europeans, and their cheeks frequently display the ruddy hue common among white men. On the elevated mountain and the table lands of South America, the hue is much lighter than in the plains. We are well aware that it has been repeatedly stated the American Indians are all of one hue. Such assertions could have proceeded only from theorists who had either a very limited or no acquaintance with them. The Arab tribes also exhibit a great variety of hues, from the black of the Maghreb of the Sahara and the dark brown of the Shegya or the native of Oman, to the comparatively fair hue of the Arab of Lebanon. The answer to such facts is intermixture. But the other features often show that there has been no intermixture. Thus, the Maghreb Arab shows by his features, hair, and general expression that he is not blackened by being partly of Negro descent. There is another fact which proves that the answer of intermixture is unsatisfactory. Where change of complexion is produced, as it often is by intermixture, there's only an approximation to either of the colors. Thus, the mulatto is never as black as the Negro. Now, in the cases we have mentioned, there is a complete similarity of hue. The argument from intermixture is further rebutted by historic knowledge. Thus, the Jews are a people who have ever, according to the prophecy, dwelt alone without intermixing with nations to this day. So they were staying separate. Again, this is common. We've seen this with Hannah Adams. They didn't mix. We see this Claudius Buchanan. They didn't mix. Now we're seeing this treatise to geography by Abe Barrington saying they did not mix. Now this separate race, all descended from brown ancestors, for Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob must have been as dark as Mar Yohanan, if not darker, exhibit every shade of color from the black Jews of Malabar, whom we have such an interesting account by Dr. Claudius Buchanan, that's who we just looked at, to the rose and lily complexions of the Jewess on the banks of the Elbe. We need go no further than the Jews of southern Spain and compare them with those of Holland and northern Germany to perceive a very striking difference. The Spanish Jew is always dark complexioned and his hair is uniformly black, whilst the German Jew is often as fair as any German and has light or red hair with blue eyes. The various shades of color observable among the Negro or African races tends to the same conclusion. Along the coast of Guinea, which is low, marshy, and hot, we find jet black complexions, and this is the very country from which American Negroes have been derived. But when we come to the elevated, we're not going to get into all this other race stuff. You guys can read all of this for yourself. Matter of fact, I'll just read this last little bit. But when we come to the elevated regions of the interior and pass into southern Africa, we find the very same race of various shades of brown, from dark mahogany to a light copper. Who else is described as copper in the Bible? Christ. I'm just going to point that out. Like that of the Fulas or the Kong Mountains, the Creator does not produce great changes in organic beings by sudden starts and bounds, but wisely introduces them by gradual alterations. Hence, when races change their localities, the color as well as other characteristics changes only by degrees. But in the course of ages, it always conforms to the climate, and hence, without a single exception, we find all races long settled in the low, marshy, and hot regions very dark or black, and those long resident in cool, equitable climates, fair complexioned. So wait, after a while, those in marshy, hot places turn black, bringing us back to Egypt. Those in cool places turn white. Where did Japheth settle? So we have people who were not ignorant. They had an idea of what was going on. And they had an idea of who was who and what they looked like. So it says, those long resident in cool and equitable climates, fair complexion. While in regions of an intermediate character, we find an intermediate color. The Africans of the northern states are already several shades lighter than their Guinea ancestors. Even in those cases where they're thoroughly Negro hair and features show that they are not of mixed descent. So he was saying that they were getting lighter because the climate was different. All right, let's keep going because I want to show you guys a couple more things and then I'm going to wrap this up. All right, so now we're going to look at Cambridge University again, Blacks, Jews, the Religious Challenge. If you guys are familiar with Covey the Clown's attempt to debunk this, he equates personal opinion with historical observation as if the two are equal. And he says personal opinion somehow debunks historical observation. This is why I call him Covey the Clown. So, again, if you don't know who that is, it doesn't matter. Do me a favor, hit the thumbs up if you haven't done so already. This is Blacks, Jews, the Religious Challenge, page 231. We're going to start right here. The hypothesis of the existence of African Jewish communities. He claims this debunks itself somehow, but we're not going to get into that. So I'm going to read down to let me see. We'll read down to page right here. All right. So now we're going to read this. Remember what we covered so far. That the Portuguese Jews remain separate. We just read that the Spanish Jew is always dark complexioned. We read that they were put into Spain during the time of the Babylonian captivity. And if you know about the Inquisition, Spain chased them into Portugal. Portugal deported them into West Africa. Hannah Adams says that they were the tribes of Levi, Benjamin, and Judah. And we know that there's a long tradition of the descendants of the transatlantic slave trade identifying with the tribe of Judah, whether it be in the Caribbean or here in America. The descendants of the transatlantic slave trade have a long history of identifying with the tribe of Judah. So now I'm going to read this to you, and we're going to see if we can connect the dots. Remember, the Portuguese Jews, the Spanish Jew is always dark. A lot of stuff that we covered. It says, we know that the Jewish religion is one which is passed from parents to children, and that it is fundamental. It is the fundamental ingredient in the cohesion of the group. When one studies the Jewish religion, it is clear how much it serves as the armature and the armature, the context for society. In the case of Black Judaism, the study of the significance of religious life and social life can help to rediscover traces of a more ancient Judaism that some African groups could have adopted and that could have been conserved by their slave descendants on American soil. Now, we're also going to read in this same source that some slaves said that they were the descendants of the children of Israel. You guys have heard me go over this source many, 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 many times. So we're not going to get sidetracked with all that. I'm just going to read this again, even though you guys may have heard it. Were there Black slaves who were Jewish through religion who maintained the faith of their ancestors after they had been forcibly transported to America? So they're asking the question, could they have brought this over here with them? And some of y'all have seen me read the other source where I read that the Judaism was the ancient religion of West African, or the ancient religion of Africans. It didn't specifically say West. It was there before Islam. And so you have Judaism, Islam, then Christianity come through. Well, not necessarily in that order in every part. Sometimes it was Judaism, Christianity, Islam, or Judaism, Islam, Christianity, depending on what part of the continent you're in. Some people like to say it's a specific order, but some stuff reached parts of the continent before other stuff in some cases. Says, only through the analysis of the mythology of the Jewish African origins of the Black Hebrews will this become clear. The following are the major sources that need to be considered in such analysis. Remember, this is Cambridge, and people claim they debunk Cambridge. Make them show you the retractions that Cambridge said. You know what? We got it wrong. All the information we published is wrong. They'll claim that we've been misreading the history, even though I just showed you people of multiple other races from different parts of the world saying, no, you guys are lying. Egypt was Black. The Middle East was Black. We read in the Bible that says the Middle East was Black, and specifically Cushite. We've read all this. And yet they say we're taking it out of context. It says, only through an analysis of the mythology of the Jewish African origins of the Black Hebrews will this become clear. The following are the major sources that need to be considered in such an analysis. Witnesses, tales of the explorers who mentioned the existence of communities of Black Jews on the African continent, and particularly in the areas where the slave ships picked up the Black slaves. So Cambridge, this is Ulysses S. Santa Maria specifically, is saying we need to consider explorers' tales about Black Jews in Africa, specifically where the slave trade was, which is why I pointed out the Spanish Inquisition overlaps the transatlantic slave trade. The Portuguese Inquisition overlaps the transatlantic slave trade. The Portuguese were deporting Black Jews into West Africa where the transatlantic slave trade was taking place. These things are historically consistent, whether you want to believe it or not. So witnesses' tales need to be considered, and tales of the explorers. It says B, rites and customs which have more or less explicit analogies with those of Judaism. They are investigating the Lemba. They are investigating the Igbo and their traditions and seeing how they line up. I'm talking in modern times. You guys can Google this. C, the semantics and dialectology of some African societies reveals some features compatible with those of Judaism, the language. And in this document, it says they spoke a mixture of ancient Hebrew, Maghrebian Arab, and local Patois, which may explain why the writing on the church in Savannah, Georgia, has characters that look like Hebrew and Arabic. And some say it may not be language, but they spoke a mixture of Hebrew, Arab, and local Patois. It was a hybrid language, which probably led to hybrid letters. This to me does not seem hard to figure out. And yet you find that many apologists want to debunk the church that it had anything to do with Hebrew or any of that other stuff. They want to debunk it because they don't want it to be black people, because they know the implications. D, the deductions and conclusions of anthropological and sociological work done in Africa. You guys can look into that. It is well known that 1500 years before Islam, Judaism was present in Africa. Remember when I told you it's Judaism first, whether they got Christianity and then Islam in some places, or Islam and then Christianity in some places, Judaism was there first. This right here confirms that. I have another source that said that as well, that it is Judaism is the ancient religion of Africa. It is well known that 1500 years before Islam, Judaism was present in Africa. Travelers' tales and stories of journeys across North Africa and the Sahara and the Sudan prove considerable evidence of the existence of Jewish communities on the African continent. And this was published in 1987, by the way, if I didn't mention it. We know from the time of St. Jerome, 340 to 420, a chain of Jewish commercial towns stretched almost uninterrupted from Mauritania to India. We just covered India, Dr. Claudius Buchanan. St. Augustine learned Hebrew in Tanzim, where there was a Judeo-Syrian colony which came from Cyrenaica. These groups went as far as Akkar in the southern Sahara, and according to the Chronicles of Sudan, the dynasty of the kings of Ghana originated in this group. So the Ghanaian kings originated, according to this, from Hebrews or Israelites. Go see where Ghana is, West Africa. Jewish contacts and influences with Black Africa were also noted by the Arab geographers Ibn Khordadeb and El Bikri, who stated that the roots of the trans-Saharan trade, in which Jewish caravans and interpreters were involved, culminated in Ghana and in the lower valley of the Senegal River. So it stretched all the way into West Africa. Jewish trading routes stretched over into West Africa. And yet they want to say that there's nothing, has nothing to do. The town of Judah, the kingdom of Judah, has nothing to do with actual Jews. Portugal deporting Jews into West Africa has nothing to do with actual Jews when we see a kingdom of Judah there. Do me a favor, press 1 if that makes sense. 2, if it sounds like absolute BS and nonsense to tell me that there is a kingdom of Judah and that there were Jews that had a trade route there and some Jews were deported there, and you're telling me that the kingdom of Judah has nothing to do with Jews because the word Wida means bird, and then we know that different groups of people called it different things. We know this. It was called Wida, a Judah, Judah, and Wida. We know that it had multiple names. We know that Wida means bird, and yet they're not trying to tell us that these people were bird people. They're not telling us they're descended from birds. They're avoiding the conversation. When you hear a deceiver tell you that Wida means bird, instead of actually addressing who the people are, understand that they are attempting to deceive you. Yes, Wida means bird, but it has nothing to do with the people. It was called Judah because they were believed to be descendants of the tribes of Israel. That's from I believe that was 1880 or 1881 source, the French source. You guys can go through my videos and look through all this stuff. I have all this stuff documented. It says in the 12th century, El Idrisi, the Andalusian geographer, also cited the Hebrew colony of Lamlam, 200 miles from Timbuktu. Timbuktu is in Mali. That's in Africa. If you go read the book From Babylon to Timbuktu, Timbuktu is the place being talked about here, where Lamlam says there is a Hebrew colony. Idrisi says that Lam Lam is a Hebrew colony and it's located 200 miles from Timbuktu, and the existence of two Jewish towns on the Niger. So the Niger River is over in Nigeria, where the Igbo are, and the Igbo are considered to be descendants of the ancient Israelites. We can go back to the 1600s. John Ogilby said that there were Jewish towns on both sides of the Niger. We can go to other sources to say that there's 115 towns of the tribe of Judah there. We go to sources that say that these people believed that they were the lost descendants of the children of Israel, and so they called it Judah. All this is historically consistent. All these videos are on my channel. Go watch some of my playlists. There's a playlist section on the main page of my channel. You guys can go click those playlists and just binge watch all those videos. I cite source after source after source. It says, then one century later, Haji and Agwadi added this. There's a race of people in Togut called Majahariah who are converted Jews. So talking about converts. Their women speak Hebrew in order to not be understood. From this period onwards, there was a very significant Jewish influence throughout North Africa. So the converts are in North Africa. Notice they didn't say that the Western ones, the ones in West Africa, are converts. They say these ones in North Africa are converts, interestingly, to such an extent that Dominican missionaries had to learn Hebrew and Arabic. See, we'll keep going. We're almost through there. All right. But what about the south of this margin of Saharan contacts? In the reign of John II of Portugal, we're coming back to this again, nearly 700 Jews were taken from their kin and deported to the island of Sao Tome on the west coast of Africa. So John II, you're going to see this is J-E-A-N here, sometimes spelled J-O-H-N, sometimes it's spelled Jao, J-O-J-A-O. This is why it's important to understand history so that you know when people are talking about the same person, even though they spell it different. So John II of Portugal is going to deport Jews into Africa. What kind of Jews? Spanish Jews. We read that the Spanish Jews are always dark, and we read that they had been put there during the Babylonian captivity. So if we start from the Babylonian captivity and Nebuchadnezzar, and they got put in Spain, and they were dark, and they're always dark, Claudius Buchanan calls them the ancient Jews, and then they end up in Portugal, and from Portugal they end up in West Africa, then there should be some consistency in the story. So let's keep reading. I don't want to get ahead of myself. I almost said something that was going to get ahead of myself, but let's keep going. All right. So this island is close to Nigeria. Remember, I told you I'm 48% Nigerian. Cameroon and Gabon. These are all West African countries. Escaping from Sao Tome, the Jews immigrated to the coast of Angola between 1484 and 1499. So they got off Sao Tome and ended up in Angola. So now they're on the main coast of Africa off of the islands. They must have settled in several Portuguese colonies and over the centuries mixed with the indigenous black population. And then we read when they start to mix with the indigenous population, they start to look like, and people can't tell the difference in their customs and look. So now you have these Jews off the island who are now mixing with the indigenous population. But remember, the Spanish Jew is always dark. So these had to be dark Jews that got off the island. These weren't white Jews. Near the Congo and Gabon in 1776, black Jews called Bavumbu, or even Mavambo, Mayambo, May, or Mavumbu, lived on the coast of Luango by the river named the Rio Muni. It would seem that they adopted Christianity at the same time as maintaining their Judaism. Sound like what was going on in Spain and Portugal during the Inquisition, what we just read, that some of the Jews were pretending to be other religions. They were outwardly Christian, but they were secretly still practicing Judaism. All this is consistent, and yet people claim they debunked this. And this is why they don't want to go and show you, wait, this corroborates this and this corroborates that. You have dishonest people like Covey the clown, and you have the deceivers that give him a platform to push his deception. They're all in on it together. Don't let them fool you and pretend like somebody's neutral and they're just hearing out the information. No, they're all in on the deception together, because you will notice that deceivers get a platform to deceive, and they never require them to corroborate what they're saying. Deceivers gonna deceive. So by 1847, this is roughly 18 years before the end of slavery in America officially. We know it didn't actually end because people weren't actually released immediately in some cases. By 1847, Dr. Livingstone discovered a group of educated blacks living in the interior, some 200 miles from the coast of Luanda. So educated blacks. These blacks were called the Jews of Angola. They were good merchants, learned easily, and had a knowledge of Portuguese law and history. So wait, there's blacks that are Jews with the knowledge of Portuguese law. And we know that these Portuguese Jews fled from Spain. And we know that the Spanish Jews are always dark. And if they're always dark and they were put there during the Babylonian captivity, it means that they were dark during the Babylonian captivity, which means they were dark before that. And yet they say, we're making this up and we're using the Bible to, we're taking the Bible out of context to push race. No, history lines up when it's told in truth. There's consistency when you're teaching the truth. There's a bunch of holes when you're sitting there trying to lie and deceive people and giving people a platform to deceive people. They were often employed as clerks and writers. For Livingstone, there was no doubt but that these people were the descendants of those who had been deported from Portugal in the 15th century. So these blacks, David Livingstone, believed that they were descendants. They were black Jews, but they were descendants of the Portuguese who had been deported. Now, remember, this is published in 1987. We read from sources published in the 1800s that they were black. Multiple times, the Spanish Jew was always dark. The other man believed Mary's mother was black. We saw that they celebrate, or he believed that Mary was black. And we saw that the Orthodox Christian Church says that Mary's mother was black. So there's consistency all around this. Except for when you start teaching people that they weren't black. Let me see. Other evidence supports his intuition. In Savage Africa, Winwood Reed writes of having met in Guinea blacks claiming to be Portuguese around 1864. So this is 1 year before the end of slavery in America. Closer to our time, Dr. J. Krepel noted sometime after the First World War that a large community of black Jews existed in the interior of Dahomey. Now, we have seen sources that said there were 115 towns of the tribe of Judah there. But what happened? Dahomey invaded. I believe 1726, they invaded the kingdoms of Ardra and Whitta. And they conquered. And they sold many of them into slavery. If you watch the movie The Woman King, it paints the women of Dahomey as some kind of heroes, the kingdom of Dahomey, and it says the kingdom of Whitta was selling people into slavery when that's not true. What happened was in 1726, Dahomey came and conquered Ardra and Whitta, and they sold them into slavery, and then Dahomey becomes Benin and Togo later on. See, when we know history, we kind of know what went down, and people can't pull the wool over our eyes with a movie. The movie The Woman King was historically inaccurate. It's meant to paint the villains as the heroes and the heroes as the villains. It's trying to say that the Dahomeyan people were being sold into slavery by the people of Whitta, which is not true. It was the other way around. But they didn't want to tell that story. They wanted us to spend money and praise the people who sold our people into slavery. That was the deception behind the movie. And that is my main reason I did not watch it. Says, these Jews had the five books of Moses written on old parchment of Hebrew. All these disparate elements are evidence of the permanent presence of a Jewish tradition within African ethnic groups, which had at one time been in contact with the Jews who came from the Mediterranean, were converted, and had kept their faith and their way of life. See, they assumed that these were converts. They assume that these were converts because they are of the assumption that the original Jews were white. Why are they under the assumption that the original Jews are white? Well, if we go back here, the Census Bureau classifies them as such, a person having origins in any of the original peoples of Europe and the Middle East or North Africa. You heard from the Egyptian man that they tried to force him to classify as white, even though he was not black. You heard from the other brother talking about how they are devoid of history, and they want to say that because people look away now, they looked that way before, and that somehow people didn't migrate. And then you heard the other woman, who is, I believe, a PhD. She's saying that these terms, sub-Saharan Africa and North Africa, didn't even start to be in use until the 1970s. And it was so that white people can claim antiquity and separate themselves from black people, as if there's a magical boundary line between Northern and sub-Saharan Africa that keeps people separate. This is all deception. Satan deceived the whole world, and people act like it's just about whether or not Christianity is the truth, whether or not Jesus is the savior. No, Satan deceived the whole world. This is epic level deception. Read Psalms 83, read throughout the whole book, not just Psalms, the whole Bible. But this is epic level deception on a next level. It's an attempt to rewrite history, because if you rewrite history completely, then people won't know who they are. And if the people don't know who they are, how can they turn back? Because the Bible says they would turn back. And just in case they get the idea they're supposed to do that, let's put this shell religion, this modern Christianity, not biblical Christianity, but this modern version of Christianity, which celebrates doctrine and paganism over the word of God. Let's be like the heathen. Oh, well, how do you know? Well, that's because you know I'm a Christian because I treat my family good and my wife good. But yeah, but we can't tell because you celebrate pagan holidays like all of the other pagans out there. Y'all look like pagans every other day of the week. We don't know what you're doing at home in private. That whole candle under the bushel thing. They wanna be like everybody else in public, and they want to be Christians in private. They'll say they're Christian, but then when it comes to celebrating and everything else, they're not separate in any way, shape, or form. They are not set apart. And this is the problem. They want to be like everybody else. Nothing matters anymore. Who you are, your lineage don't matter. And then if your lineage don't matter, all them promises in the Bible made to a certain lineage don't matter either. They want to tell you that God, the Father, was lying. He was just talking to be talking. He didn't really mean to follow through with any of it. He didn't care about any of it. He went ahead and just canceled out that whole part of the book because Christ came. But Christ said he didn't come to destroy the law. They'll tell you the laws of Christ and love God and love your neighbor, and yet ignore every other time he quoted from the Old Testament and told them to follow the law. They'll latch onto this one piece and say, these are the laws of Christ. Even though there's nowhere in the Bible that says, hey, this specific time right here where he said this, these are the laws of Christ. There's nowhere in the Bible that says that. They picked what they wanted to pick and said, these are the laws of Christ. And so no longer does any of this stuff matter. They take the Bible completely out of context, and then we start reading through different books that these people were black and have always been black. The entire area was a Cushite area that Abraham was called out of, and yet they want to say that sub-Saharan Africans have no history in the Middle East. Well, then just call the Bible a lie. Just say that. It would be easier if they just called the Bible a lie, but they dance around it. If they want to believe that there were no black people in the Middle East, they got to explain away Genesis chapter 10, Cush, Nimrod, Babel, Shinar. They got to explain it all away. So anyway, I was going to go on, but it's getting, you know, long. So what I'm going to do is I am going to drop a part two to this, and we're going to get into some more information about the history of black Jews and the conspiracy to change race. The conspiracy to change race, to change who's who, to make people who they aren't, and to disenfranchise people from who they are. Make sure y'all hit that thumbs up button. If you enjoyed this, do me a favor, press one, hit the thumbs up button, and make sure you share this video. There is a crystal clear conspiracy to manipulate and change history and erase black people from the Middle East and from North Africa. Again, I know those aren't the terms we've always used, but people know what we're talking about when we say it, so I'm using them. And we can see this right here at the Census Bureau. One more time, I'll read how white is classified and black. White, a person having origins in any of the original peoples. That right there is key. Original peoples of Europe, mm-hmm. the Middle East, or North Africa. If they are original, they're considered white. Rewind this video. Listen to the other people talking. If you missed it, I had an Egyptian man saying how he, a black Egyptian man saying that he was told to keep his mouth shut and classify himself as white. Black or African American, a person having origins in any of the black racial groups of Africa. So even if you have to classify as black or African American if you're from Africa. How does that make sense? You can just be a color, or you can be a combination of two continents if you are from any black racial group in Africa. It don't matter if you're North Africa, Sub-Saharan Africa. You're black or you're African American. That's it. You're not Middle Eastern. You're not North African. None of that. You're just black or African American. So just understand that we are facing heavy deception, and I believe a lot of the apologists are in on it. They are choosing to be in on it by being ignorant of the history, by trying to manipulate the history, by trying to debunk everything. They have already made up their mind what they want to believe and what they don't want to believe. So anytime any information comes out and they say, oh, well, I don't believe this, so I need to debunk it immediately. They're not really investigating. What they're doing is they're trying to shoot down a belief that they don't want to believe in. And no matter how much evidence there is, they will never believe it. Proverbs 18:13, I believe. A fool, or it's a folly and a shame to answer a matter before hearing it. I'm paraphrasing. Or he who answers a matter before hearing it is a folly and a shame unto him. It means foolishness. If you're out there listening to fools, what would that make you? If people who haven't heard the evidence are saying that's not real or that's fake or that's a lie and they haven't studied it, they are fools according to the Bible. And if you're listening to fools, what does that make you? I just want you to ask yourself that question and be honest. If you're listening to a fool, what does that make you? If they don't have sources to back their claims, if they don't have any kind of information to back any of their claims other than they heard somebody else say it, why are you listening to them? If they can't give you sources to tell you that the Ashkenaz disappeared magically and that Jews came over and started calling themselves Ashkenazi, tell them to show you sources. If they can't explain that and show you the sources, why are you listening to them? There's a lot of deception out here, and you guys need to stay alert to that. So anyway, I'm going to wrap it up here. Hope y'all enjoyed. Make sure you support patreon.com/DanteFortson. Check out amazon.com. Put my name in and you can see all the books and stuff that I published. And make sure you hit that thumbs up button and Cash App anytime. Cash tag BHITB. And with that said, till next time, I'm out.